Hopefully we can get a few more people in here. I'm just kind of buying my time before I start because it's really difficult for me. Here's what's difficult for me. I have a problem leaving anyone out. If I could just get over that one weakness and be comfortable leaving people out, I wouldn't have a problem. I just want to bring everybody along. I don't want to leave anybody out. So the person comes walking in 10 minutes late, I'm like, I got to start over because they're not going to understand what I'm going to tell them because they weren't here from the very beginning. And I'm telling you, people, if there's one thing that everyone should get is that we live in the last days of seducing spirits and doctrines of devils. We live in a time where people are just more interested in the sensational and fantastical than they are in the truth. God's word is truth and everything else is just forget about it. Someone was telling me the other day about how they really are champions of truth and how that God has given them the word of knowledge. Basically, I'm giving them the word of his word and they've come to know his word so that now they can stand in the seat of judgment. I'm like, hey, just time out. There's none of us that are that smart. Our perceptions aren't that sharp. Let's just stick with the word of God. And you're not, you know what? If the Lord hasn't placed you in the seat, in the position to be a leader in his church at this juncture in time, to watch over people, to tell them when they're right and tell them when they're wrong, then don't do that because there's no sense in you doing that. Right. Father, raise up people to say, no, that's right, that's wrong. Then they have it on their own head. And if they're walking with the Lord, Father is going to give them the wisdom and the insight so that their counsel will be from the Lord, and so that they're not going to be ashamed in the day of judgment. If you're not given that anointing and you're not given that place, the best thing is just to grow in grace. Okay, does that make sense? Tonight, I feel an urgency about this because I know that there's one person that's getting ready to release a book on the Eighth Kingdom, and another person has already released a book on the Eighth Kingdom. Please don't mess with my overheads, okay? And so, I am earnest about this. I'm just earnest about this because they're just wrong. They're just absolutely wrong. They are just speculating. And once again, they're pointing people's attention towards something that is not true. I had a person call me up and they said, so-and-so said, this is going to happen, and this is going to happen. I said, it's not going to happen. They weren't asking me about a financial crisis or this thing. I don't know about that. But when you start telling me something that I know clearly in the Word of God, what the Word of God says, I can tell you, that ain't going to happen. Somebody said, wow, he's an accurate prophet. Yeah, the Word of God will make you an accurate prophet. It's amazing. The Word of God will make you so smart. You'd be able to see into the future because you just, you know, look into the Word. Somebody said to me, well, how are you so sure? Because I know it doesn't line up with the events of the Word of God. So people say that they're seeing that ISIS is the Eighth Kingdom. That is absolutely crazy. If they had, and they put themselves in the position before the people as those who are expert in prophecy, who know what God said in his word. If you're expert in prophecy, it has nothing to do with your ability to function the word of knowledge, really. It's your ability to accurately communicate the word of God, something that anybody else can look at and go, wow, this is a little bit hard for me to see, but I'm going to study more. Or people can look at it and go, wow, this is really what it says. When you begin to deal with the symbols of prophecy, the one thing about the symbols of prophecy is they're very complicated because God does a lot of connecting the past with the present and the future. He connects them. And then you've got to be able to understand how to rightly divide the word, and you've got to understand how to keep yourself on focus within the framework of what God is discussing. I'm going to tell you tonight that before the Eighth Kingdom can arise, three great events have got to happen. First and foremost, I'm going to prove to you a world war of proportions that have never been, can't be described by World War I or cannot be described by World War II, has to happen. I'm going to prove that to you tonight. Second thing that's going to happen is out of that war will come the formation of what I have coined. This is me coining it. Other people have called it other things. This is what the Lord laid on my heart to call it, because I want to make it very descriptive. The empire of the 10 kings. That has to happen. And that was that. And with when I, as I begin to tell you about the empire of the 10 kings, you're going to understand, before that could ever happen, you're going to have a world war to shape that. And then out of the empire of the ten kings, once that is in existence, the Antichrist will then rise up out of that. He won't rise up with it. He will come up out of that. It will already be in existence. Somebody says, how long will it be in existence? I don't know, but I do know this, that those kings of the that formed the empire of the ten kings, now you listen to me because it's going to keep you from deception. This is going to be allowing you to predict the future. You understand me? The Word of God will allow you to predict the future. It'll allow you to distinguish between lie and truth. This stuff isn't, people just act like this is more important information than how to make $1 trillion. This is information that is absolutely going to keep you from deception. It's going to help you understand and how to prepare for the coming events in the future. And that's why I like to pull on people, please give this more attention than you would to any other subject. And if you will, you'll be blessed for having done it. And so out of that, out of the rise of this this event of the empire of the ten kings, we'll see the formation then of what's called the seventh kingdom. That begins and starts Revelation chapter 6, where we see the Antichrist come on the scene, the one that we call the Antichrist. And I'm going to explain this more to you. And then he will then continue for about 3.5 years to dominate all of the ten kings that belong to the empire of the ten kings. And then when he does, at the middle of that time, which is the tribulation, in the middle of that time, he's going to do something that is going to change the dynamics of everything that is going on and that has ever taken place. He's going to go into the Holy of Holies in Jerusalem, and he's going to proclaim himself the one and the only Almighty God. At that moment in time, a religion is going to be destroyed. And as the religion is the mother of harlots, and many false things have been said about the mother of harlots. Now they're saying it's Mohammedism. Let me just tell you something. I want to help you understand that Mohammedism is a relatively recent religion. It was birthed in the 7th century. What, 7th century AD. It has nothing to do. The mother of harlots has nothing to do with Islam. It is spiritual Babylon. And what we have to understand is that she has existed since the very beginning. You listen to me. She's existed since this mother of harlots, this mother of idolatry, this mother of witchcraft and of sorcery and of every diabolical thing that leads men away from God. It is anti-God. It makes the kings of ancient Babylon and Mesopotamia and Akkad and Assyria deities, God kings. And I'm not going to go into that tonight, but they are anti-God. They believe that they themselves are God. And there's a whole list of them. At some time in the future, of course, I'm getting ready to release a book that will show and outline all of these various kings that believe that they themselves were God. They stamped things as though they were it. They were God. And so that's ultimately what the Antichrist is going to do. And we're going to be able to know where there's truly the Antichrist because God shows us the exact geographical location from which he comes. He shows us every dimension and detail by which ultimately it develops to that point. This crazy notion, Social Security, mark of the beast, credit card numbers, mark of the beast, new chip that they're coming out with for I don't know what it is, you know, is geolocators or whatever, carries all your financial information, mark of the beast. Nonsense. Has nothing to do with it. This ultimately, these things will begin to come on the scene in the middle of the tribulation when ultimately he then institutes a new religion, which is to worship him and Satan. Satan, people are going to worship the Antichrist and give their power to the Antichrist because they're worshiping Satan who gives him the power, literally. And so, you know, the book that I'm writing right now is, and trying to finish up, is really about showing the sorcery and the witchcraft and the magic and the enchantments and all of the things that went on within the framework of men interacting with angels after the flood, beginning with Nimrod, who is the king, the man, the individual, who is the one who founded Babylon, who had as his empire capital Nineveh. And we know what the prophets would say about Nineveh. One of the things that Nahum says about Nineveh could be no, I mean, there's nothing more exact in God's description about Nineveh concerning the mother of harlots than actually the passages of scripture that you find in Revelation chapter 17 by itself. And I don't know how much I'm going to be able to go into that tonight. You know, and I've given you, like, I think we've done about 11 or 12 overviews of the book of Revelation. It's just scratching the surface. And I've told you that over and again. But, I mean, there's so many details here. You're going to have to give your life to studying this. Fortunately, we can build upon those people who have gone before us who gave their life to studying these things. So, ultimately, what I want to, you know, get across to you tonight is that the next thing to look for is a world war that will be a world war in a proportion that is absolutely unlike any world war that has ever taken place up to this point in time. And the end's still not yet. And out of that world war, if it is the right world war, there will be a formation of a dominant world power that will come right from here. And what I want to, this is the exact location. I'm going to tell you, listen to me. This is the exact location that God gave to us by his servant Daniel almost probably, 400 years before this. This is the ancient Roman Empire. And if you look in your Bibles in Daniel chapter 7, what happens in Daniel chapter 7, all of a sudden, the Lord begins to unveil to Daniel some very unique things. And describing the various different kingdoms that will come after the kingdom of Babylon by different beast and symbolism within the beast. And so what he shows is a fourth kingdom that arises. And this ultimately starts off with Babylon, a lion. It then moves to a bear, Medo-Persia. Then it moves to a beast, the leopard, which is Greece. And then it moves to a beast, a terrible beast, that has iron claws and whatnot. And various different description, and it has 10 horns. And out of these 10 horns comes a little horn with a mouth that speaks out great blasphemies, okay? Now, what we can understand about that little horn with a mouth that speaks out great blasphemies, both not only from Daniel chapter 7 and Daniel chapter 8, but Revelation chapter 13 and 17, we understand that this is the Antichrist. He has a mouth that produces these great blasphemies, and he's a king that ultimately he himself is destroyed by the Almighty God at the coming of second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. And it helps us to understand that that king is the king of the last day, and that king of the last day emerges or rises up out of this empire of 10 kings. Now, if we back up a little bit before that, and everybody knows about this to some degree, and unfortunately, I don't have the pictures because of some miscommunication and whatnot here tonight, but you can see the picture and the image in your imagination. And that is the image of Daniel chapter 2. And beginning right around about verse 40, you see an image where that God describes to King Nebuchadnezzar, which then ultimately Daniel interprets concerning all of the kingdoms that are going to be unto the coming of the Lord Jesus, until the coming of the Messiah, the second coming, the one that, in which he comes and sets up his kingdom. And see, that's the most important point here. We recognize, wait a minute, there is an event, there is going to be a king, a blasphemous king who will make himself God, whom Christ Jesus will destroy at his coming, and the result will be that the kingdom of the Lord Jesus Christ, that the kingdom of God is set up on this earth. And that way we've got pegs in the ground. We know exactly what's going on. We know the duration of time in many respects in these various different events. So I know I'm probably pushing some of you to an extreme here, and I don't have a lot of pictograms for you to be able to see. Hopefully you can keep up with me. But what we see is the image of the head of gold, and we see the arms and the chest of silver, and we see the belly and the loins of brass, and then we see legs of iron, and we know that, and then we see feet of iron and of clay, And we know that the head of gold was Babylon, and the arms and the chest of silver was Medo-Persia. Then after that, the brass represented the Grecian Empire. And then after that, there was the Roman Empire. And this is something that is validated in secular history. And these are the great empires of the world. These are the great empires. There were other empires, but these are the great empires, and especially with respect to not only their influence, but their impact upon the nation of Israel and this particular region. And as far as the development of the Western world, it is it. This is it. This is Western civilization, ancient history. Are you with me? Okay, so what we see is that Rome was an Eastern and a Western division. This is very important for us because it helps us to then more perfectly identify where this Antichrist is going to come from. And then in this Western and Eastern division, there's feet of iron and clay, and it has 10 toes. Are you with me? Yes. Now notice that there's no little horn coming out of those toes. And there's no little horn coming out of those toes because that's not talking about the seventh kingdom. It is talking about the kingdom or the empire of the 10 kings. Okay, something that is developed and is in place before the Antichrist ever comes. And it is specific because, once again, this is the image, the terrible beast that you see in Daniel chapter 7. This is it. This is the region. This is the Roman Empire right here. That takes in between 40 and 50 known nations right now. We're talking about nations like Germany. We're talking about nations like England, France, Spain, Portugal, Holland, Iran, Iraq, Jordan, Egypt, Libya, all the way over to Morocco. It's three continents. Three continents. And so what God did for us in the revelation of that he gave in Daniel chapter 2 was he showed us that you can't fulfill prophecy because you've got some kind of, you know, European Union. Because that it's got to, five of these kings have to come from the Western division, and five of the kings have to come from the Eastern division, and you're going to have all three continents included for that to happen. You understand me? So, in other words, back I think it was like in the 50s or something like that, there was the formation of the European Union. And everybody said, oh, that's it. That's the rise of the 10 kings. That's not the rise of the 10 kings. Because first and foremost, it is a federation of 10 kingdoms in the division of the Western and the Eastern Empire. Somebody said to me, do you know that all 40 to 50 nations, which would include, remember, it's going to include Greece, it's going to include Czechoslovakia, Yugoslavia, Bosnia, Serbia, it's going to include Turkey, it's going to include so many of Armenia. Armenia, you think Russia's going to let go of Armenia? Russia has shown you can have Georgia, you can have Armenia. You cannot have Armenia. Are you listening to me? Yeah. To see the development of some 40 to 50 nations suddenly be included into a 10 kingdom. I'm talking about 10 kingdoms with 10 monarchs. I'm not talking about typology. I'm talking about it's going back, hearkening back to the type of kings and monarchs that existed back in the days of Nimrod, back in the days of Sargon, back in the days of Sennacherib, back in the days of Nebuchadnezzar, back in the days of Alexander the Great, and Alexander the Great represents in his fashion, in his culture, in his demeanor, in his military expertise, in a demon power, angelic relationship, cultic relationship, the Antichrist more than any single person in history. And Daniel goes to great pains to prove that. We have two chapters devoted to us that people don't understand. Daniel chapter 11, Daniel chapter 12, devoted to us to show us exactly where the Antichrist comes from. And so, you know, I'm passionate about these things because there's no reason for us to think it's Mussolini, Benito Mussolini, Hitler. They don't even come close. They're not even on the blip. I can say this, at least ISIS is in the right geographical location, but they still don't fit because the religion is wrong. We know about their politics, we know about their sociology, we know about their geographical location, and we know about their religion. Islam has nothing to do with it. Some people were trying to say, that the mother of harlots was the Roman Catholic Church. And yeah, does the Roman Catholic Church today have Babylonian cultic symbols in it? Because there is a Babylonian cult. And the Babylonian cult can be traced all the way back from ancient Mesopotamia, which when we then link that to Nimrod, we took all the way into the Roman Empire, all the way into the Romanization of the church that happened under Constantinople. True, but the Roman Catholic Church still believes in Christ Jesus, the death, burial, and resurrection. They believe in the fundamental tenets of the faith. They're not anti-God. There's no way. And besides that, Rome is not even mentioned in the scripture. It's Babylon. It's not the city Rome. It's the city Babylon. And you're going to have to jump over hundreds and literally thousands of inferences, but hundreds of clear, plain verses of scripture to make what's going to go down take place any other place than Babylon. Babylon is a spiritual city, a mother of harlots who's been producing idolatry, sorcery, witchcraft, all kinds of immorality, all kinds of evil things since its conception. And, you know, as I said, I'm finishing up a book. I'm trying to list all of those things of Nimrod's wife and how she deified lasciviousness, and she deified sexual immorality, and how that through that, and how Bacchus is another name for Nimrod, because they got, you had to, in order to interact with the angels and the demon spirits properly, you had to get drunk on a special concoction that he himself invented that we have to this day, beer. He specially invented it with special types of mixtures to make it just what he felt it had to be to ultimately get the results. Remember, Nimrod's the guy who built the ziggurat. He built that temple, a temple that then was transferred. His religion was transferred to all the nations of the earth. And how was it transferred? Because he was the first great antichrist type who gathered all of the nations together under one language, and they had set to build themselves a ziggurat, a temple that would defy God, that would reach even into heaven. That if God ever did send a flood, he couldn't catch him or couldn't get him. That he had a vengeful position to where he was going to take revenge for their ancestors, for God having destroyed them. God, Jehovah, Yahweh, the Almighty, is the God of chaos in the Kigama, in the various different Gigamash and other epics of ancient Sumeria, of the Babylonian religion. God isn't the one who's good. He's the one who's evil. He's the one who destroyed the earth with water. Are you listening? He's the one that they try to appease so they don't get destroyed again. Okay, and there's a whole lot of more information to give on that, and I can't really give you that. All I'm trying to do is just begin to set a little bit of a tone for the interaction of men with angels and the understanding of the dynamics that are going to go down there, and the rise of witchcraft and the rise of sexual immorality. All these things are just preparing the way for something so evil and so sinister that men cannot even imagine how that ultimately there would be people under the reign of some of these, like the son of Sargon. People would come and they would offer themselves to him in sacrifice. They would kill themselves in front of him. They'd put a spear through their own neck. And nobody commits suicide as a sacrificial offering. And he would stand there stomping on them as they fell right, left, and center. I mean, some of the things that went on in the cults of South America among the Aztecs, you know, and others, and the Mayans, I mean, that where they would sacrifice literally tens of thousands of human beings to appease the gods. That's like the baby pool stuff. That's like Sunday school stuff compared to what these tyrants that believe themselves to be God incarnate demanded from men as they subjugated them and made slaves and tattooed them with their deity, their mark of their deity, the mark of their demon, the mark of their angel, the mark of their of the way that they interacted with spiritual beings that was unique in that day. And you know, we say, well, those people of old, they were superstitious. No, they were more perceptive. We become less perceptive on this side of the Enlightenment, where all of a sudden we've now become more deceived and try to shut out the realms of the spiritual. They were that much more interactive with the realms of the spiritual, keeping in mind that before the flood, literally, the cherubim angel was there guarding the way to the tree of life because Adam was still alive. Right. Are you listening to me? And that's why when you look on the various different reliefs in the of the Syrians and of the Babylonians, you see cherubim angels. You see the winged angels standing there with the king, who is a God incarnate, eating from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, and try and giving each other the fruit of the knowledge of good and evil. This stuff was a reality. We want to try to make it fictional and legend. The Word of God is not fictional and it's not legend. Are there legends that are based off of all these events that happened? Sure. Greek mythology has a lot of legend with it. And there's a whole bunch of legend with other nations. But you know what? Would you? What is one of the interesting things to find out? One of the things that for example, the Jesuits were bowed over by when they first went into China was to discover that there in China was the Babylonian cult. They're already existing. It went to every nation on the planet. Why? Because they left Babylon. You know what Babel means? Confusion. Babylon is the city of confusion. Satan is the author of it. And so I'm just trying to set the tone to see that all the rebellion started in a place called Babylon. And there's so much scripture devoted to this seat of idolatry, the seat of sorcery, the seat of witchcraft. Every kind of crazy enchantment that you can imagine came from there. Genies in the bottle, angels in the bottle came from there. Flying carpets came from there. Yeah, I'm happy to say it's legend and folklore, but I'm going to tell you right now, every crazy sorcery, witchcraft, interaction with angels and spirits, it all originated from there. And I'm telling you something, there was things going on because we've got proof of it. There were men, the daughters of men, interacting with fallen angels and creating a superhuman race out of that. Yeah, it happened before the flood to where that we could see that Noah was the only one who was perfect in his generation. One of the things that would cause us to stand back and go, wow, you mean he was the only one not polluted with these things? You know, we could also interpret that other ways, but nonetheless, that is a valid interpretation. But it happened again, and we know that it happened again because God, in the Septuagint, in Deuteronomy, it calls it, Moses refers to the Valley of Giants. That's not what it says in the Septuagint. It says the Valley of the Titans. And that's where we got this idea from. And somebody said, that's Greek mythology. Yeah, it is. But it's also some related to real events that took place. David killed the last of the giants. Goliath was a giant. I mean, Og's bed, he was 15 foot long. I mean, come on. I mean, I went to a Sudan exhibit back in the 70s, it's been pulled. I can't even find any trace of it. And it had all of these artifacts of giants. I saw with my own eyes. This is not a conspiracy. This isn't something you got to call it, you know, and find out and try to validate over there, you know, at some, you know, Smithsonian Institute. I was there in Louisiana, in New Orleans, looking at an exhibit that they say doesn't even exist anymore. I mean, the crowns were this big around. They said, oh, and the people that were presenting said, well, those obviously those had to be symbolic crowns of the greatness of their kingdom. Sudan. I'm telling you, the rings for their fingers with the jewels on it, they were huge. They were this big around them. You know, their weaponry was just completely out of proportion. Are you listening to me? The release that they had, I mean, I'm telling you, we're talking pointed ears. It was wild stuff. And you know, you think, wow, this guy has really lost his grip of reality. Listen, I was at the exhibit. I'm not hearing something from someone else. I was at the exhibit. I spent the day at the exhibit. It just so happened that the Lord set it up for me. I was 17 years old. It was one of the most dramatic things that stood out in front of me of the giant that inhabited the earth. Now, I know there's a lot of stuff on the internet, there's a lot of fake stuff that's going on, and you got to be careful about reproducing that and saying, oh, look, they found this and they got the evidence of this, and you got to be careful about that because then ultimately you could be found in the middle of some kind of a scam, and then everything that you say is just wrong as well. I'm going to speak from the scripture. I'm going to talk from the Word of God. And so when we want to, one of the most important things is that I want to get across to you is this is the region from which the empire of the ten kings come. This is the capital of the world. This is the world dominating power in the last day. And it, you can, somebody can say, well, I can see that for Europe, and I can see that, you know, for the way things are shaping up over here in the Middle East. Yeah, but what you got to understand is it's got to involve all three continents. It has to, because God made it that specific for us. He didn't leave it for us to just guess what part of the Roman Empire this is going to come out of. And so then when you take it that far, then you're saying, yeah, more than likely it includes all of these nations. And that's why I like to lay out all of the various different maps concerning all of the kingdoms that are highlighted, not only by Daniel, but also by John, because there's seven kingdoms, beginning with Egypt. Egypt is the first kingdom that oppressed anti-God, anti-Christ kingdom, who was, they believed that there, that Pharaoh was God, who worshiped all kinds of demon spirits, who had all kinds of idols in God, had all kinds of crazy interactions going on with angels. You can see it in the pyramids. There are so many mysteries in the pyramids that nobody could even get it. Why? Because they're interacting with evil spirits. They're interacting with angels. And they're the first ones to oppress the people of God. Anything that God's doing, they're fighting it and they're trying to destroy it. Kill every male that is born. Cut those people down, you know. This is, it was in that condition, climate, in which Moses then was brought into this world. So then we got Assyria. I can go on and on talking about Assyria and its anti-God and its anti-Christ and how that they had purposed to totally annihilate all of Israel. They were able to annihilate the northern kingdom because God gave them the power to annihilate the northern kingdom. Why? Because of the sins of the northern kingdom. They came to do the exact same thing to the southern kingdom, and that's the dialogue that's going on between Rabshakeh and Hezekiah that you read about, because he was the emissary of Sennacherib, one of the great-grandsons of Sargon, who himself believed to be God incarnate. He was God. There is no God but me. And he made people. If you didn't accept him as God, he would kill you. These were head cutters, man. They cut everybody's head off. They made the blood to flow. Hey, the woman, listen, the scarlet beast is not scarlet just because that was a nice color for the day. It's scarlet because it is a bloody, bloody kingdom. And it's a bloody kingdom, more bloody than ever, of anything that ever existed. And I want people to get this. ISIS is nothing. I agree with Obama. They're junior varsity. Okay, they're nothing. We've made them bigger. We could have stopped them. Any of the powers that be, Israel, little Israel, could have stopped them in a day. Just put them, basically taking out their chain of command, their power. There would have been just a little bit of cleanup they have to go on. Huh? Listen, they are junior varsity. And we make it so big. I mean, it's the newscasters, spincasters, you know, basically they wake up in the morning and decide what they feel you should believe. And so they don't come tell you the news. They come to tell you what you should believe. Are you listening to me? Yeah. And so we have to understand this. We have to understand that Satan is the prince of the power of the air. We have to understand that Daniel showed us how governments work. He was praying, interceding that Israel be delivered from Babylon. And what happens? The prince of Persia withstood him so that his prayers could not be answered. So he could not receive help from heaven. Huh? And then the prince of Persia, what did he rule over? That angel ruled over Persia. Are you listening to me? Medo-Persia's angel ruled over Babylon. There was an angel that ruled over Assyria. There was an angel that ruled over Egypt. There's an angel ruling over the governments of this world. It's happening right now. People are blinded to it. They don't have perception. They don't have a dimension of being able to see what's really here. We've lost it because we've been indoctrinated into a culture that is totally brought us into a little box of a false reality that we live in within the framework of the Western culture and Western society. And then we see the Prince of Grecia come. The Prince of Persia's time was over, and now the Prince of Grecia has come. And when the Prince of Grecia comes, and we know the Prince of Grecia, the Prince of Grecia stands out to us in the scripture because he's the one who came up out of the bottomless pit and reigned over and gave to Alexander the Great his power to do the things that he did to subjugate men. A great cruelty beyond Genghis Khan, beyond all Hitler, beyond all these guys. These guys were juniors compared to what Alexander the Great did. He was merciless So cruel, his subjugation of man for his mandate to Hellenize the world. True. Sargon was worse. Nimrod was worse. He was a mighty hunter of men. I'm going to tell you right now, they learned that. See, they were more actually showing to us and demonstrating for us the very nature of fallen angels that have come to tempt you with all the things that you can't seem to live without because they're hunting your souls. And all they did was they displayed it in a greater way. I'm telling you right now, we think that we have a modern society that can hold back that kind of tyranny. We can't. It's all decided in the heavens. It's not decided in the governments of men. Huh? And we know that John said, he was talking about that. He said that concerning the beast, which speaks not only of the Antichrist power that he gains after, he declares himself to be God. At that time, he is anointed by Satan in another way. Satan is cast down from the earth in the middle of the tribulation. Right there at the most important time point. The most important time point in the tribulation is the moment in time of the abomination that makes the temple desolate, because we've got a number of counting days, 42 months, all the way down to the number of days, 12 or 16 days. And that is the middle, it's 3.5 years. That's the middle of it. Okay, it's a very important time point. That is a moment in time that he's anointed. That's the moment in time that the eighth kingdom begins. That's when Satan worship begins. That's when people have got to take the mark of the beast. That's the time that they've got to worship the image that he makes of himself or of Satan. I'm not sure which one it is. It sounds like it's of himself. And then the false prophet that is with him, who's also been anointed by an angel from hell. Now, I'm talking about people. I'm talking about these guys have signs and wonders. You know what Paul said about it? 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 7. He comes with the power of Satan, with every kind of sign and miracle and lying wonder to deceive the nation. We're talking about men who have human beings who have the power to create an image of a man, of the Antichrist, of the beast, what we call the beast kingdom, because he is a beast. He's a terrible, devouring, cruel beast from hell in human form. You listen to me, because he's that possessed. And he's got that power reigning over him. And this is most certainly going to happen. And we're not there yet. And that's not sensational. I start telling people, look, this has got to happen. This has got to happen. This has got to happen. People are looking at me like, oh, man, you're not orthodoxed. You know, you've forsaken the theology. No, I live like Jesus is coming today. But I know of these certain events that are going to happen. Paul said, of course, you understand, when Paul began to talk about the last day, he did not have the book of Revelation. We got something that Paul did not have. We got insight that Paul did not have. He said he believed he was going to be alive when the Lord came. He said, we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord. You know, so the reality of it is we live that way, and I have that posture. But I also know what God said has to be set up in his word. And it just so infuriates me that we are sending all of our money and all of our resources to prop up and empower these people who speak all this sensational nonsense and at the expense of being able to have wisdom and insight to perceive what's going to happen, so that we're not yet once again crying wolf. To just prove at the end of the day that we didn't know what we were talking about. Therefore, all they're saying about God isn't true. All they're saying about Jesus isn't true either. Because that's the fallout. That's the end result. I know people back in the 70s. I remember back in the 70s. Oh, we're not going to live the year out. And the year's not going to end. Back in the 70s. Jesus is coming this year. Here's the proofs. I said, those aren't proofs at all. Those aren't even proofs. Has nothing to do with it. People look at me like, oh my goodness, you must be, you know, a heretic. Hey, guess what? It didn't have nothing to do with it. Jesus didn't come. And how many people fell away because they came and responded to Jesus and the message of Jesus, because this guy was showing these proofs at how the Lord Jesus was going to come next year, because the Antichrist is about to be revealed, and here he is, and here's the 10 kings the 10 kingdoms. I the Lord put in my spirit to solidify it. Empire. So people don't mistake some loose federation of a couple nations. Okay? I hope you can feel my passion. I hope you can get this. I hope you'll study the Word of God. I hope you'll really study the things that I put before you and say study. You know, I'm a little overwhelmed that there's not more interested people in this. And then I look at these guys who are speaking nothing but nonsense, and their place is packed, 20,000 people, place is packed. And they're speaking a bunch of trash. There's no basis in the scripture, no basis in reality. And what's going to happen? Hey, I'm going to tell you right now, ISIS is going to cease to exist. They're going to get blown off the map. They're not even a power. Give me a break. I mean, what logic could make them some kind of significant power? The Antichrist is going to rise up in some significant power. This is a fortifiable force. Okay? And this is why we know that this is talking about. And God gives us proofs. He gives us the evidence. Why turn to something else when we've got the evidence? He gives the evidence. He shows us the eastern and western divisions of Rome. We know that this is the geography of that time. This is it. This is the geography right here. This is from the Encyclopedia Britannica. This is it. I didn't color in these spots. This is accurate ancient history. This is the Roman Empire divided in western in eastern divisions, from which comes 10 toes without a horn. And then when you look in the Daniel chapter 7, and I believe, I believe it's right at about verse 20, that you just see that after these 10 kings rises up another king, the little horn of fierce countenance. And it's very clear. Afterwards, so that we see more clearly when we look back at what God was showing Daniel in chapter 2, yeah, that is the empire of the 10 kings. That is what makes ready for the Antichrist to come on the scene. When you open up your Bibles and you look at Revelation chapter 6, you see this guy on a white horse that comes with a bow. That's him. Huh? That's him. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Hallelujah. It's chapter 6, right? Chapter 6. Chapter 4 and chapter 5 is about what's going on in heaven. Chapter 6 is what's going on in there. Correct? Is everybody with me?
Yeah.
I get some hand signals. I love hand signals and I just, questioning looks, because I'm not willing to pause and make sure that I'm giving you the right reference. Yes. The facts are right. Yes. The references may be off, okay? Hallelujah. So very, very important for you to begin to understand these things. It's important for you to understand the change in the dynamics. Let me set this up for you. Look, there are going to be angels flying through heaven, Revelation chapter 9, saying, do not take the mark of the beast nor worship the image. It's going to be, look, the perception is going to be back. It's like the veil is removed. People are going to look up into heaven, Revelation chapter 6, they're going to see Jesus, the Lamb, sitting on the throne. Huh? Think about it. Demon locusts. That are like men, but have a sting in their tail, are going to come forth, tormenting and stinging men with the torment of their tail. Just the appearance of them is going to be terror enough to the human mind. Much more the sting. We're just getting started. We haven't even got in. We're not even into the beast kingdom yet. This is the seventh kingdom. This is the unveiling of the thing. Listen, the angels are going to begin. The fallen angels are going to be interacting with men on another level. Listen to the four angels that are bound right now in the river Euphrates, which I believe are bound there because they taught men a special form of magic and sorcery and witchcraft. They're not like those who committed fornication with women are bound right now in hell. These are unique. I have specific beliefs about them that I have come to. And because I look at what their work is, they're going to destroy one third of men. They are going to lead a huge army that you read about in Revelation chapter 9. The horses have heads of lion. Out of their mouth comes fire. Their tails are a serpent's, and at the tip of the tail is just a nice little hair that looks so cute. It is the head of a serpent that bites men, and they destroy one third of humanity. Think about this, people. We're just getting started. This is just warm up. We're talking about things, and here we got people out there saying that we're in the middle of the tribulation. Are you crazy? Are you doing this for money? What's going on here? I mean, I'm telling you, I'm passionate about this thing because I believe that it has an impact on creating a greater deception and blindness of heart to the lost. Because I watched it happen. And I heard about it happen before I was born. I watched it happen when everybody's running around saying, Jesus is coming this year. It's going to happen this year. And here's the proof. And it didn't happen. And so many people's hearts sank deep. They said, wait a minute, this person I put my trust in said all these things, and they were all wrong. So it was a wide open door for Satan to come in and tell them, yeah, and they're wrong about everything else too. What happens when we begin to become accurate? And then all of a sudden, people are going to see as Nebuchadnezzar did, a people who are full of the wisdom of the Holy Spirit, full of the wisdom of the Almighty God. And we're going to be right. We're going to be accurate every time when we speak the word. You know, there's times I've asked the Lord to say, Father, give me insight and details about the future. And I'm always feeling the Spirit of the Lord. I mean, never heard it, but I'm always feeling the Spirit of the Lord saying, I have in my word. Speak my word. I always hear the Spirit of the Lord saying these things to me because, you know, not too long ago, the Lord told me, it was a number of years ago, the Lord spoke to me about 5 or 6 years ago. He said, I want to show you with greater clarity what's going to come in the future. You know, and I'm just like thinking, you know, wow, I'm going to have some great, I'm going to have these great revelations and insights from heaven. Well, really, what I come to understand is Father says, study my word. I'm going to show you from my word what's going to happen so you can speak from the highest ground and the highest place of authority of something that is forever settled. It's not subjective. Right. You don't need another witness on whether the Bible is right. You hear me? Yeah. If we can just stick with the word, there's going to be all kinds of fantastical things because Satan will create the fantastic and he will propagate it as truth and will be easily, gullibly swept up into it and then be speaking it out of our mouth and invalidate all the truth that was in our heart. We just got to get to a place where we say, look, I don't know. I'm uncertain. I don't know. Let me tell you what I do know. I do know that there's going to be a world war that's going to shape this because it's not going to happen on its own. Yeah. It's out of these 40 to 50 nations, it's 41 nations, and about 9 of them are in question because it's not certain as to how much of them were actually included. It's Portugal, Spain. It's United Kingdom, France, Morocco, Belgium, Netherlands, Germany, Switzerland, Italy, San Marino, Vatican City, Malta, Austria, Czech Republic, Slovakia, Slovenia, Croatia, Bosnia, Hungary, Yugoslavia, Albania, Greece, Macedonia, FYR Macedonia, Romania, Bulgaria, Turkey, Georgia, Armenia, Azerbaijan, Syria, Iraq, Kuwait, Cyprus, Lebanon, Jordan, Israel, Saudi Arabia, Egypt, Sudan, Libya, Tunisia, Algeria, Morocco, Palestine. That's a lot of... You're going to get them together in 10 kingdoms voluntarily with 10 kings. And I'm not just talking about, you know, Queen Elizabeth. Huh? I'm not just talking about King Hukatani and over there in Africa. I'm talking about tyrannical monarchs. Because that's how it's set up. I'm talking about Caesars. I'm talking about Xerxes. Xerxes is a lion just like Caesar is, you know that? Like pharaohs are. I'm talking about pharaohs. Because that is the part. Why? Because it is their religion. It is the religion. It is the religion that is seen in the mother of harlots. It's something that they bought into. It's a power that rules over them, that dominates them, that expresses itself through them because they're demon-possessed with an angel from hell. You with me? Somebody said, I can't be demon-possessed with an angel. You got an angel rolling over you with all of his demons and all that. He works his works through your emotions and the outworking of your life. It gives you power to subjugate men. Think about it. Where men, I mean, these are real release. Where men are standing before a God king and they're so overcome by his power, they drive a javelin through their own throat. By the thousands. Come on, man. We don't know anything about this. We can't even begin to relate this. And so we're all sitting around here biting our fingernails about ISIS. Give me a break. A couple of people got their throats cut. A couple of people got burned. That ain't nothing to compare to what this cult that represents Satan's hideous tyranny of manslaughter, manhunting, manslaughter to subjugate you. You're either a slave that he walks on and wipes his feet on, or you're dead. Choose which one. And his power, the authority, The demonic anointing is so overwhelming, it causes people to fall out. It causes people to tremble with fear and intimidation just looking at them. We don't know anything about these things. We can read about them. If you're a student of ancient history, you can begin to become aware of their power, of their charisma. You say, how did Genghis Khan do what he did? And he's a lightweight. How did Alexander Great do what he did? How did Nebuchadnezzar? How did Sargon? How did Sennacherib do what he did? You listen to me. So, once again, you know, this is the Roman Empire that represents the Eastern and Western divisions of the image that we have given to us in Daniel chapter 2. This, which we would be very familiar with, all of us should be very familiar with these nations, the sovereignty of these nations, just the sovereignty and the power of Germany alone. Huh? We should all be very well attuned to their own, to the sacredness of their motherland and their devotion to their government and their devotion to their heritage, to realize they're not going to form 10 kings out of 10, they're not going to form 10 kingdoms with 10 kings without a major war. Ain't nothing to be looking for at this point in time other than a world war of proportions that you cannot even imagine. Now, think about this. If this is the world power and this is the center of everything that is going on, where is China? Where is Russia? Where is the United States of America? Why aren't they no power here? Well, I know that Russia as a government in some form or shape is going to still be in existence, because the Antichrist, who is called the King of the North because he comes from the ancient Assyrian Empire right out of Syria, proven, comes right from where Antiochus Epiphanes came from, the fourth. Are you listening to me? Huh? Does the same thing that he did, but on another scale. Two chapters in the Bible devoted to helping us understand exactly where he comes from. Because when you read in Daniel chapter 7, we see when the little horn comes up, after the 10 horns exist, or the 10 kings heard exist, and this new king rises up, which caused Daniel to wonder because of the way it took place and the way how soon he came up. Right? Remember that? Are you with me? Without me having to read the verses of scripture to you, go back and study them, because I'm giving you the format to be able to understand them. Right? He plucks up three. And of course, it says, I believe it's like Daniel 10, 16, right around in there. Daniel says, I'm giving you this, the Lord says, I'm giving you this vision so you may perfectly understand the things that will happen in the end. And then he gives them the vision of chapter 11 and chapter 12, and it goes, and it a lot of it has to do with a 150-year war that takes place in among those kingdoms that fell out of the Alexandrian Grecian Empire. Remember, because then if you look in Revelation chapter 8, you see that Alexander's empire is represented by one horn that's broken off, and four horns come up, and out of the four horns come up a little horn, once again with a mouth that identifies that, hey, wait a minute, the Antichrist once again has something to do with the geographical location and socio-political religious nature of those four kingdoms, those four great generals of Alexander the Great. And then we see that he jumps from ultimately what took place at the end of that 150-year war, culminated with Antiochus Epiphanes, and then he jumps immediately to a king that ultimately is going to be destroyed by the King of Kings. So we know and the King of Kings is going to immediately set up his kingdom, so we know that didn't happen in 160 BC, right? And so, you know, this is where we will get confused. But I want you to stick with me, because I want you to understand what God is doing is he's painfully breaking down the geographical location so that you and me can know exactly what's going on and how to prepare for it and how to work towards that end. God, the Lord didn't just give us this for information only. He gave it so we can know how to move with him, how to work with him, how to prepare for what's coming, not that these days should take us unaware. Well, I'm going to be able to see this. I'm going to be able to tell you, once there's a world war that forms, ultimately changes the whole landscape of these some 50 nations, listen to me. Don't let anybody deceive you. Nothing's going to happen till this happens. Don't let anybody deceive you. This is on God's calendar. People talking about the Shemitah year. And this year, this month of September, it sounds like a religious Y2K to me. I mean, everything's going to bust. Everything's going to break down. Everything's coming to a total collapse. It's insanity. It's insanity. I mean, I just received a word from a person who's on the inside who knows about the guy. I can't remember his name. Is it Khan? I didn't want to say that. Khan. It's, you know, Madoff. You know what I'm saying? Madoff made off with the money. You know what I'm saying? Sometimes names reveal some stuff. I didn't really want to say Khan. But he said, are you still like me if this doesn't happen? I'm going to tell you, it ain't going to happen. It ain't going to happen. It ain't going to go down like you're saying. This ain't happened. It ain't going to go down. The eighth kingdom ain't here. Hello. We're not in the middle of the tribulation. We're not under the sixth seal now. Baker, get a grip on reality, man. Selling more food products so everybody could go hide away, you know, while the Antichrist is basically doing his thing and a filter for nuclear radiation and plenty of beans and whip it up soup and whatever. Give me a break. And then the people they're pouring in the finances. Hundreds of millions of dollars of God's money is going into all this nonsense, all this deception, while the world goes untouched with the gospel. It's nuts. I hope somebody else gets as upset about as I am. I hope the whole church does. Then we could go in another direction. Go in another direction. So he said, man, he's on the soapbox. He's spitting and waving his hands and screaming and hollering like he's got all the answers. I don't have all the answers, but I know the Word of God. I know the Bible. I can tell you right now, this stuff is nonsense that people are talking. We used to think that people were wild-eyed with their things that they said about prophecy back in the 60s and 70s. We had no idea that it would come to this. I mean, just read the natural disasters that would have taken place in the earth if we were under the sixth seal. That will sober you up right there. I mean, there's somebody saying we're in the trumpet judgments. I just like, Lord Jesus, why? And they got millions of dollars. I mean, one person was bragging after they're having their raise-a-thon or whatever it is, that they had $400 million or something like this, $400 million in the bank already. And pleading with the people like they're gonna basically go belly up unless you get some more money in here. It's nuts. It's insanity. It's making merchandise of the gospel. It's about how much people don't want my book. Why? Because I'm not marketable. Look at me. I'm not marketable. They're not interested in something, the truth. They're interested in something they can make money off of. This is crazy. People, look, understand we're living in the last days. And have some wisdom. A world war is going to take place. I don't know how many world wars are going to take place. But I'm going to tell you, there's a world war that's going to take place that's going to take something that has existed for more than 1,000 years. And it's going to rearrange it in a way that nobody thought was even possible. And it's not going to be just right up here in Europe. And it's not going to be just right over here in the Middle East. Or it's not going to be just right over here in Africa. And when you begin, it's got to be part of all of that. And if it's going to be part of all of that, I pretty much am confident it's going to include it all. That the prophecy is going to be accurate to the very exact detail. Are you listening? That's just the way it works. Because that's the way it worked in the past. Look, if you just did nothing but read, make a study of Daniel chapter 11 and Daniel chapter 12. Look at the crazy accuracy and the little details that were absolutely fulfilled. That was prophesied 300 years before it happened. If it's going to be, if we can now superimpose that. I mean, there's people who say there's no way that Daniel was written before that because there's too much details, too much accuracy of details. This is on the level that somebody had to actually have eyewitnesses and written it afterwards. The details are just too perfect, and they're just too minute. The minutia of the detail, it just can't be possible that someone prophesied with that accuracy. He did. You know what that causes me to feel? Wait a minute. If that kind of detail was fulfilled with that kind of accuracy, then let's go ahead and make the same conclusive, beliefs about the rest of it. I don't want you to believe this nonsense, and I want you to help people to understand. I want you to be able to speak boldly and confident when somebody says, "Is the eighth kingdom's rise?" You simply say, "No, it isn't." There's four major events got to happen before that. You got to have a world war. And it could be a world war that takes place here in the near future. China and Russia have been doing naval and military exercises together since 2005. Just last week, they did one of the biggest ones they've ever done. That would cause you to shake in your boots. That is one big, huge federation. You've got all of China's naval power and all of Russia's naval power joined together doing joint exercises under one commander. And it's been going on since 2005. And we're sitting over here going, sleepy, sleepy. Let's get everybody together and sing Kumbaya. We'll all have it. Because all of our presidents have been smoking dope since they were 16. My dad told me, other people told me, he said, "Listen, man, all these guys smoking dope and doing acid, they're going to be the president one day." And sure enough, we got Clinton, then we got Obama. Sure enough. And George W. Bush, he was a dope smoker. Just sing Kumbaya. Who's got the guitar? Anybody bring a guitar with them? I got my harmonica. And this is their Camp David meetings. You know what I'm saying? And meanwhile, the government of China is going, "We got these people. Ain't no problem. They'll be bound before us. We're going to rule them." Jesus help us. Jesus help us. Jesus help us. Jesus help us. We're blind, naked, miserable, wretched, and poor. And we think we're so rich and well off. God help us. Oh, we could see if we'd hearken to the word. Ah, we'd be rich. We'd be clothed with white raiment if we just walk in submission, obedience to the Holy Ghost. God help us. But because of our spiritual state, we're believing every lie that is taught, every deception, and we're propagating it and empowering it. There is no other possible alternative explanation of this. It is what it is. God gave the perfect explanation of it in Daniel chapter 2 when he showed us what it looks like. Because the 10 kings, somebody says, "How about these 10 kings, these toes of iron and clay?" Because they're going to be in existence when the Lord Jesus comes. Because if you look at the vision, Jesus Christ's kingdom is like the Lord taking and cutting out a stone, casting it at the image. And at the image's feet. And so, in other words, when he comes, his target is against those kings and destroy the kings. And of course, we read the same exact thing in Revelation chapter 17. So how can you make this something other than that picture? No, these kings will all be alive. They will all give their power. These kings and these kingdoms will give their power to the Antichrist. And this is what the Antichrist will rule over. And when he starts off up here in Syria, he goes and he gains Turkey, he gains Egypt, he gains Greece, and then the other six give their power to him. And that's the seventh kingdom. That's the rise of the seventh kingdom. And that's when he's unveiled. As soon as he rises up, he's not a part of the federation anymore. They've got some kind of coalition, some kind of federation, some kind of agreement as the empire of the 10 kings. He suddenly says, no, he's now got a power, he's got a mantle, he comes on the scene to make war. That is Revelation chapter 6, riding on a white horse. He looks like the Messiah. He looks like the Messiah. Israel mistakes him as Messiah. Jesus gives a little bit of clue. He says that You reject me, I'm your own, you reject me. One is going to come that's not of you, him you're going to accept. It's just a little clue. We don't know, but we do know that he makes a 7-year covenant with Israel. There's some kind of an affinity going on with Israel. Israel somehow got some kind of appreciation, some kind of value. Somehow he's able to walk into the holies of holies. Somehow he's able to make Jerusalem a capital city for a while before he moves it to Babylon, which becomes his capital city for the eighth kingdom. Because as soon as he says, I am God, and proclaims himself the one and only almighty God, as his predecessors did, as Alexander the Great did, as one of the sons of God, huh? An incarnate God. You listen to me. Huh? Then that what's immediately going to happen is that's the beginning of the eighth kingdom. He moves his throne now. Let me just read this verse of scripture because I think it's so profound. And I'm going to come back and I'll talk about this because these kings are alive. I want you to understand that. These kings are alive. They give the power to him and they go with him. And so they give him his, by the time the first three and a half years are over, okay, he has conquered Egypt, he's conquered Turkey, he's conquered Greece, just like you read about in Daniel chapter 11 and 12. The other six kings go ahead and succeed and give their power to him. And then, and that's the time he proclaims himself God. And that's when they kill the Babylonian cult religion. That's when they kill the mother of harlots. That's when they destroy that religion that has dominated them since the ancient Babylon, which God takes up with Egypt, okay? Because she's riding on a beast that has seven heads. Because really, the most formidable kingdom and empire was Assyria. But Egypt is the closest thing to it. And Egypt's on the map, whereas Nimrod or Babylon or ancient Sumeria or ancient Akkad are not on the map because Israel wasn't on the map. There wasn't a distinction between that who was God, those who were God's people, and the nations. Every time we read about Gentiles, it's just a word that we use for nations. Goy is a word, ethnos, Hellen. Those are words, those are Greek, those two words, Hellen, ethnos. Those we translate Gentiles. Just simply means nations, huh? And when we say Hellen, we're actually saying Greek nations because the world was like looking at everybody as Greeks if you weren't a Jew. Are you listening? Can you understand me? I hope I can. I'm hoping I'm making some impact here. I'm hoping I'm helping you understand something even more than just prophecy. That you realize that there is a spiritual dynamic of demon power and angelic powers from darkness that are right now moving the world because God is allowing it, moving the world towards this, the prince of the power of the air, the God of this world, the spiritual wickedness in high places, which you and I have authority to deal with. If we'll start understanding who we are and what we're supposed to be doing and quit being constantly pulled in to the snares that the prince of the power of the air is creating as they hunt the souls of men and hunt our souls. I want to read this verse of scripture to you because I just think it's such a profound verse of scripture in Nahum, the prophet Nahum. Sometimes prophet Nahum is a little bit hard for everybody to find. Turn there with me to chapter 3. And the first one that finds Nahum, give me your Bible. Nahum chapter 3. And just want you to look at, let's look at the first verse that just describing Nineveh. Woe to the bloody city, okay? Now, I want you to go ahead and look on down with me in chapter 3 and show you the declaration concerning Nineveh that is a description very close to what we have of spiritual Babylon. And it's verse 4. Listen to this. Because of the multitude of your whoredoms, of the well-favored harlot, the mistress of witchcraft. Okay? There's a whole cult. She's the queen of heaven. Literally. I'm going to tell you, on every government that exists today, you almost, in every government, including our own, there are symbols of the Queen of Heaven. And just study a little bit about American history. You're gonna be appalled. I'm gonna leave it there because I don't want to go into that. I want to dilute what I'm talking about. But I want you to understand that this is the Babylonian cult. This is Mystery Babylon. This is the mother of harlots, the mother of anti-God things, whether it's the worship of demons through idols. See, the way that they were able to get the demon to do something for them was to give certain things, offerings to these idols of stone. Okay? They were taught enchantments, sorcery, various different forms of witchcraft. And so it is out of this cult, so we hear, because of the multitude of your whoredom, of your well-favored harlot, the mother of harlots, the mistress of witchcraft that selleth nations through her whoredoms and families through her witchcraft. This is what we're talking about when we're looking at Mystery Babylon in Revelation chapter 17, and we can stack up scriptures that help to validate this. It's not the Roman Catholic Church. It's not anything like that. It's not anything like Mohammedism. This is something that this dates back to 900. This is probably right here talking about 700 BC, but it dates back to 900. And it actually goes back further than that. And I'm just strictly keeping with the Assyrian Empire in its greatness, because it actually goes back further than that. It goes back to Sargon, which would take us back to 2500 BC. And where did this cult come from? This cult came from Nimrod. Who taught Nimrod these things? Angels. They interacted with angels and demon spirits. The cult is all about that, how to interact with angels, how to interact with demon spirits. They saw everything going on in the earth, everything, anyone had any power, anybody had any advantage over someone else, it was a demon power that gave it to them. Everything in nature was some demon manifesting, some angel had some authority over, whether it was the forest or the tomatoes or the mountains or the sky or the clouds, it was some angel. And God, Almighty, the one who brought the flood, he was the God of chaos. He was the God to hate. That's the Babylonian cult. That is the Mystery Babylon. You listening to me? Okay? So, I just want to help you understand. That's the religion. That's the religion of the Empire of the Ten Kings. It's not Christianity. It's not Roman Catholicism. It's not Islam. It ain't even there. These Ten Kings that form out of these 50 nations on three continents to fulfill it, the fact that it comes from both the Western and Eastern division of Rome, will rise with that Babylonian religion. Are you hearing me? Yeah. It is anti-God. It is the tyranny. It is the cruelty of everything that Sargon was. Everything that Alexander the Great was. It's important if you realize what I'm trying to tell you. This is where the world is going. If that's point B, and we're standing right here right now at point A, guess what you can predict between now and then? And, you know, ultimately what we find is once you study the book of Revelation, you can understand why there's nothing but primitive weapons at the Battle of Armageddon. Once you've seen that there's these demon, these angels released from hell with an army of demon horses, And these special angelic riders with the demon horses with faces like lions, and out of their mouth comes fire to destroy men, and their tails are serpents that bite men with a poison, a deadly poison. I mean, that's just one little portion of it, huh? That you got this image created by the Antichrist that's breathing and living, huh? And people are being brought before it continually as human sacrifices, and heads are flying because that's just the way of the cult. The cult demands human sacrifice. So what was it you were going to invest in? Huh? What kingdom were you going to build? What heirlooms were you leaving to your kids? I mean, come on, people. If we get some wisdom and we get some insight, we know where we're moving. We're going to have a fight on our hands. We understand that we are part of the army of God. It's time to be able to take some ground before all this happens. God's given us one more hour of daylight before the darkness comes. And suddenly we begin to read, if we get a hold of Scripture and we know where we're going, suddenly we sober up and realize where we are. We sober up and we realize where we are when we understand the dynamics of the spiritual reality around us. But here's the problem right here. Anybody talks like this and talks the word, they're going to have this right here. Just a few people show up. And if you start talking a bunch of nonsense and garbage and rubbish, and it's just deception, and it's just crying wolf again to where that it anesthetizes the sheep that they'll no longer respond to the warning, thousands, tens of thousands of people come to listen to that. So what do? Do we lose heart? No. Step up the pace of the fight. Step up the pace of the fight. The fight has had everybody in this church just recognizing all you got to do is just retweet, share our Facebook post. You'll be doing more than you're doing now. I mean, we got the word, man. God gave us the word. We're anointed with the word. We're proclaiming the word. It is amazing to me. I look and see how many people share, and I'm going, okay, well, whatever. I guess they got something else. And I look on your Facebook, I didn't see nothing else but what you ate for breakfast. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
It's nuts. Use what you have to propagate the gospel. Yeah. I don't care. Write your own daily bread, but write something that's going to stir people's hearts. Amen. You know what I'm saying? I mean, I've already done it for you. Come join with me. Let's preach the gospel. Let's join in this army. Let's fight. Where there's a fight to fight. Okay, and I don't say that out of frustration. I just say that out of a sense of bewilderment. It's like, why? Why don't folks get it? Why can't you use everything that is available to you at this moment in time to advance the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, to function in the anointing of the Holy Ghost that is able to effectively deal with the spiritual wickedness, these powers of darkness that are going to be unleashed, and they're going to fully manifest their rage against humanity through men again as they did in former times. There's nobody in the modern world that is ready for these kind of dictators. These kind of dictators, I'm telling you right now, just read about Sargon, read about Alexander the Great. They make Stalin look like he was a Sunday school teacher. They make Hitler look like a good guy. I'm telling you, these are ferociously evil people, fully possessed with the rage of fallen angels. Look at the four angels released out of the river Euphrates. They are full of vengeance and rage against humanity. They want to destroy everywhere that they go. Revelation chapter 9. Just read Revelation chapter 9 a couple of times before you go to bed tonight. Huh? And that's just warming up because we hadn't even gotten into the eighth kingdom yet. Because when the eighth kingdom happens, that's when the wrath really is unleashed. Because he speaks blasphemies against Almighty God on a level that has never been spoken. He is full of blasphemies and worship of Satan, worshiping the dragon. The people who worship the dragon are the people who follow him. Are you listening to me?
Yeah. Yeah.
I believe that's 13:2 or 13:3. Revelation 13:2 or 13:3, something like that. Think about it, the people. This is where this world is going. This is where humanity is going. And we the only salt, unless we've lost our salt, unless we've lost our saltiness. Because saltiness is supposed to make people thirsty.
Yes.
I know salty won't make the religious thirsty, but salty will make the lost thirsty.
Yes.
We're supposed to be light.
Yeah.
A world war is what you're looking for, not ISIS. It's not going to be something that forms right over in the Middle East. It's not going to be something that forms over here in the European Union, European market. It's not going to be something that forms over here in Northern Africa. It's something that forms on all three continents and includes these nations. And the only way these nations, the only way Germany is going to give up its sovereignty, the only way Armenia is ever going to be giving up its sovereignty, is something major is going to happen to the reshifting of the powers that be right now. I personally believe that the United States of America will be totally neutralized. That isn't hard to see, is it? I'm going to tell you right now, when I see last week, Russia and China doing naval exercises not too far from our shores. And they've been doing it for 10 years now. This marks the 10th year of doing it. And now it's bigger and it's more powerful. Listen, our naval fleet is pales in comparison to their combined power. We don't stand a chance. Sue for peace before you start. No wonder our president's running and hiding, just trying to do whatever he can do to pacify. We lost. We sat around twiddling our thumbs. For how many years? We lost. They can do whatever they want to do, and they know it. They can do whatever they want to do whenever they want to do it. And nobody's turning this thing back now. It's too late. No military might in the United States can stand against the combined efforts and power of Russia and China right now. Listen to me. The only possibility for the United States of America is the church or revival. It's it. And we asleep and we out, people out doing whatever it is that they're going to do tonight, pacifying and their own self-interest, thinking about what they can get more for themselves, not realizing that destruction is already upon them. It's true. And as a nation, if we could just have a prayer meeting like we had in World War II, Everybody got down on their knees and began to cry out to God. But now, we got to just murder more babies for brain parts. We got to say to the sexual immoral on the highest level, we recognize you and call your unions holy. No, that's what they say. They want to sanctify their union. That word says holy. Huh. I ain't gonna ever come out of my mouth by the help of the grace of God. You listen to me, what I'm saying to you. I'm not being mean or ferocious to any people. I'm being mean and ferocious to the demonic spirits that have taken over this nation and taken over Europe while we were sleeping. Somebody said, oh, can't we get all NATO together? There ain't gonna be no way. Have we been doing naval exercises with NATO for the past 10 years? Hello? Huh? We don't have that level of organization. They've been working on it and fine-tuning it, man. You just tell me, if you think for a moment that their lustful, wishful eye is not cast upon the shores of the United States of America, you're just living in a fantasy. They've lusted for this nation for a century, nearly a century. Huh? Can I see? You know, I was reading recently, one man of God, and he was talking about all the things that have got to happen before the Antichrist. And one of the things he said is one of the big unknowns is when Jerusalem and Israel become a nation again. Because there can't be a temple for the Antichrist to come and make the desolation of abomination spoken by the prophet Daniel, which Jesus highlighted as the most important time point for us all to be recognizing, until there is a nation, Israel. I'm thinking, that's already happened. Check. How quickly, somebody said, oh, Israel has, you know, occupy Jerusalem and fulfilling of the scriptures since 1967. No, they have not. Hello? What glass? You need a change of glasses. Somebody's been feeding you a bunch of garbage. The dome of the mosque sits upon the most important part of Jerusalem. They do not own it. They do not occupy it. That's the feature. That's the most important part. That's not a check yet. But it wouldn't take long for that to happen. The things that the prophet Obadiah said, and the smallest prophet of the Bible, of the Old Testament, those things aren't happening, because I'm going to tell you what's going to take place in Bozra, what's going to take place in Timon, and the power that they will arise to. It hasn't even happened yet. Idumeans aren't even there. It's just still a rock hub, a heap of rock. But it wouldn't take long for them to be a Palestinian homeland, because we know that the Palestinians are Idumeans. We know that. Whether people want to recognize on a national level or not, we know they're Idumeans. They were recognized as Idumeans at the turn of the century by the British. Hello. They weren't off. It's just that somehow we want to make it different. Huh? The people, I'm telling you right now, there's a lot of things that are going to be happening, because the Lord describes to us that as the time approaches, that the earth is going to be like a woman in travail, like a woman about ready to have a child. And there's going to be earthquakes, and there's going to be pestilence, and there's going to be all these various different natural disasters on a scale that, you know, just continues to build and to build. We know that the plains of Arabia were fertile plains of wheat fields of grazing land. Abraham grazed his cattle there and his sheep there. And so did others in the days of Abraham. It's desert now. Somebody said, do you believe in climate change? Yeah, there's cyclic. There's different things that happen. There's going to be all kinds of changes in the earth that are going to take place. It has nothing to do with carbon emissions. There's very little. That's just all hoopla. It's all somebody trying to win a Nobel Prize and make some more money. Huh? As they fly around on their jet. What do you look for? You look for a world war. It's a terrible thing to look for, but let's be sober. What do we look for? We look for Israel taking hold and really truly occupying Jerusalem because it's still trodden down by the Gentiles. Huh? Temple will be built. It'll be built. They'll find a red heifer, a spotless red heifer, to be able to sanctify the temple. It's going to happen. There's not one right now that anyone knows about. They're trying to genetically bring it to pass. They're trying to use embryo transfer and other advanced technologies to make it happen. Now, I'm sure they're putting things together, but it ain't there yet. The temple ain't there yet. Somebody said that there's all the stuff is in place, that the temple priests, the Kohen, the Kohathites are being trained and have been being trained for the past 30 years. I don't doubt that. That's fine. I don't know that, though. I'll tell you what I will know as soon as I see a temple built. And the daily morning and evening sacrifice once again reinstituted. That's going to be huge. It's going to be huge. But don't be telling me about the eighth kingdom when there ain't even a temple. Give me a break. Don't read that mess. Why buy the book? Why listen to them at their conferences? Why not just have a little bit of sense? Why must Christians be so gullible? Because they're deceived. So many are so deceived. Why? Because they've compromised with the devil. The angels of darkness have hunted their souls and they've been taken in the net. And they compromise with the world. Lord Jesus, I'm not saying this in a judgmental fashion. And I'm saying my heart is broken. I'm passionate about this thing. I'm desperate for revival. I'm a revivalist. I'm trying to show in every way I possibly can the time point of where we're at, the will of the Father, and the purposes that God has given us right now to work while it's still light. Because the darkness comes when no one can work. The darkness comes and no one can work. It's fast approaching upon us. And there's 3 billion people that haven't heard the gospel yet. Oh, I'm working as fast as I can to see, be able to have a means to be able to multiply ourselves. Come on, people. Let's get a heavenly vision. Let's understand what's going on. Quit spending our lives for that which cannot profit. Please. Keep your eyes here. This is what Daniel said, Daniel chapter 2. What is it, verse 44? This is what Daniel said. Daniel chapter 7, what is it? When the first little horn rises up, verse 7? Or is it verse 3? I just don't have it written down. Here it is, people. The rise of the empire of the 10 kings. This has to exist before the Antichrist will ever come on the scene. Somebody said, how long will it exist before the Antichrist comes on the scene? We do not know. It's verse 8. Daniel chapter 7. Verse 8. Okay. He rises up afterwards. After this is there. Somebody said, how long? I don't know. It could be 20 years. Could be 10 years. Could be 1 year. I just know that all these kings will be in existence when Jesus comes because they will be destroyed by him. They will be in the battle of Armageddon. They will give their power. All these kings. He conquers three. It takes him 3.5 years to conquer the three. It takes him 3.5 years to come down out of Syria and conquer Egypt, Greece, and Turkey. It takes him 3.5 years. At the end of the 3.5 years, after he's conquered them, right about 3.5 years, the other six will abdicate and give their power to him. And that moment of time when he has their power, at that moment of time, he will say, I am the one and the only God Almighty. You serve me, you worship me, or I will kill you. Then, if you're in the field, do not turn back. Run. Run. Moab and Edom will escape out of his hand. So Israel can flee to a refuge there. If you're on the housetop, don't go down and get your stuff. Run. Pray that it's not winter. Pray that you're not giving birth. Because it's the troubled times. What's going to happen? At that moment in time when he proclaims himself God, he demands Israel to worship him. They will not worship him. So he sets out to start killing them. And it's the flood that the dragon pours out of his mouth that you read about in Daniel chapter 12. The scripture says the earth opens up and swallows up the flood. So what it is when we understand the prophets of what is declared to us in Ezekiel, in Isaiah, suddenly we realize that what happens is he hears rumors. He's the king of the north, sitting up here in the northern empire, sitting up here in the northern part. Where am I at? Sitting up here in the north, Syria. Okay? He hears rumors of a king from the north that hasn't given him his power. Remember, all these kings have already given him the power. King of the north has to be in Russia. He hears rumors of the kings of the north confederating to try to overthrow him. What does he do? He turns to battle against them. His false prophet works signs and wonders and miracles by his witchcraft and by his sorcery. His power is, as Paul said, is the power of Satan with all miracles, with all signs and lying wonders. And so he takes not only these kings and over here the kings of the east, and the Euphrates dries up for him. Who dries up the Euphrates? His false prophet. It's the power to dry up rivers. So that the kings of the east can come over. And it's then at the end of the last 3.5 years, the end of the 7 years, the last 3.5 years being the eighth kingdom, I'm asking a question I want to know. What is the fundamental transition point between the seventh kingdom and the eighth kingdom? What is the transition point? Anyone, just raise your hand. What is the transition point? What is the transition point between the seventh and the eighth kingdom?
When he takes all the power.
What is the transition point between the seventh and the eighth kingdom? The abomination that makes the temple desolate is when he says, I am God. It is that is the transition point. Why? Because that is when the ten kings kill the mother of harlots. They destroy the Babylonian religion. They destroy the Babylonian worship of angels. Now they're going to worship the Antichrist and Satan alone as God. You hear me? Can you hear me? Can everybody hear me? Testing. 1, 2, 3. I want you to get this. I want you to get this. I know I'm not giving you diagrams. I know this is, but you should have it. You should have taken already from 12 studies that I've given you, and you should have gone and more passionately pursued understanding what I've already laid out for you so that you know it, so that I could give you more information and you can take it in and understand it. But if you just basically don't do anything with this, like so many people don't do anything with the anointing, you're never going to understand. This stuff is not that difficult to understand, but you've got to give yourself to it. Will you please?
Yes.
Please, give yourself to the study of these verses of Scripture so that you can understand. What makes what's the single biggest difference between the seventh kingdom and the eighth kingdom? Remember, the seventh and the eighth kingdom exist in the 7-year tribulation. They don't exist outside of it on either side. Are you with me? It starts with the rise of the Antichrist to conquer three kingdoms. It ends with Satan coming with all the armies of the earth to try to fight against God, and God destroying the armies of the Antichrist. Satan is bound for 1,000 years. The Antichrist and the false prophet are thrown into the lake of fire, and the Lord sets up his kingdom. Hallelujah. And it becomes like an exceeding high mountain that fills all the earth. What is the primary difference between the seventh kingdom and the eighth kingdom? One word, and only one word. Not politics, not geography, not sociology. You only got one left. Religion. Religion. It's the only difference. Can you hear me? Am I helping you? Am I breaking through here? I mean, I know I got to come out against the forces of hell that don't want anybody seeing this, because all of a sudden, every one of their cards are fully revealed. Every one of their actions could be fully made known. I pray that you'll earnestly understand that your life is wrapped up in this. That your understanding of truth, of whether you're deceived or whether you walk in truth is wrapped up in this. Religion. The seventh kingdom is ruled by the Babylonian harlot. So is the empire of the ten kings.
Yeah.
Somebody said, how do you know that the empire of the ten kings are there? Do you have absolute proof? I don't have the absolute proof like the proof of the harlot riding upon the beast with seven heads. I know that the seventh kingdom is definitely under her domain. But Rome was definitely under her domain. And my evidence is that the eastern and western divisions that were under her domain are so connected to the feet of iron and clay and the 10 toes that I have enough evidence from just that description in Daniel chapter 2 to know that these empire of the 10 kings is ruled by the Babylonian religion, by the religion that I just described to you in Nahum chapter 3, what was that, verse 7?
4.
Verse 4. Thank you. I want you to get this. I'm going to diagram it. Listen, I'm going to diagram it. I'm gonna write it out. And so I'm writing it out in such detail in this book that I'm just finishing up, that I've spent so much time and labor on. I was 12 hours doing it yesterday. And if people don't read it and study it, I don't know what I'm doing. I may quit. I may quit the ministry. I'm not going to quit the ministry. But I mean, you know, come on. I've done some stuff that that I know would change your life. I just gotta know that people are willing to be serious with God, because Father sees your response to these things. If you start just responding to the Lord in a proper way, just telling him how desperate you are to have a relationship with him, you begin to put that into action by the way that you respond to temptation. I'm telling you right now, your relationship will go through the roof. The anointing, the manifest presence, the power of God will be, come on, all time high. I just want you to give yourself these things. I want you to know them. Because, all of a sudden you're in a situation where you need to teach people and say, well, we got to call up Pastor Mark. Well, I'm going to keep my phone off. I'm not answering. If you ask me a question about this on the phone, I'm not going to even answer. After I put out the book, I'm like, read the book. People, you ask me stuff about the new man. I said, I wrote a book on it. Read the book. It's there with all the scriptures. It's there. It's laid out for you. Read it. Study it. Huh? Come on, man. It's not time to be spoon-fed, please. And just understand my passion here, because listen, the world is lost. It's in such a desperate need. And the only possible remedy is you and me. God wants to raise up great champions. Yes. You know, he's not, unless you understand the Word of God, unless you study the Word of God, you have no possibility of being a champion in the kingdom of God. No possibility of moving forward in the realms of the anointing. None of what Father's purposed. Set your heart on this. Amen. Don't let anybody lie to you. You know, ISIS, no other little power, no Germany by itself, no Iraq, Iran by itself, no Egypt by itself. No way can they fulfill anything that has to do with the end times. No way. There could be movement in preparation for this, but it ain't no big movement. There's none of this big movement has been taking place. I want you to walk out of here tonight realizing that the only big sign that you know that things are getting close is the formation of the empire of the 10 kingdoms from almost 50 nations that are all sovereign right now, who will not for any reason give up their sovereignty. And there's deep tradition in Germany, deep tradition in Spain. Deep tradition in Holland, deep tradition in Iran, deep tradition in Egypt, deep tradition in Morocco. This is formed. It's a federation. They may be tyrants and they rule with an iron fist. They dominate the world. Would you see that? I believe the temple in Israel will be built. That the evening and the morning sacrifice will already be instituted. Do you see that? And there's no temple in Israel for the evening and the morning sacrifice. No temple for the Antichrist to walk into. The temple's not going to be built in the tribulation, people. Did you read what's happening in the tribulation? Everybody is on the run. You know what I'm saying? The only people that are protected is 144,000 Jews. And they're busy doing other things. It has to be built before. If you see this, and this is in place, but the temple is not built in Jerusalem, you know there's time. We're still waiting. The Antichrist is not going to come on this. The time is not yet. Many false Christs will come, not just one. The Antichrist rides a white horse. He comes as a Messiah. He comes as the Christ. He is the Antichrist, but he comes as the Christ. He comes as the Christ. You can't be a false Christ unless you come as the Christ, can you? Does that make sense?
Yes.
Now you understand how that he makes a 7-year covenant with Israel, how that he can make Israel, as it were, his temporary seat of power. Because he's doing miracles and signs and wonders. Somehow he passed all the tests. Jesus says, you reject me, I'm your own. You reject me, but one who's not your own, you're going to receive. Can he be revealed on the scene right now? Can the Antichrist be revealed on the scene right now?
No,
because this doesn't exist. This has to exist, and then the little horn appears. Then the Antichrist is revealed. Then the man of perdition is revealed. The man of perdition cannot be revealed until these things happen. And when you begin to understand it in this context of Daniel chapter 7 and Daniel chapter 8, you then can understand 2 Thessalonians with a little bit more clarity. I'm just going to stay with this till I feel like people got this. I'm not going to walk out of here just having gone, womp, 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 womp. Wow, it was amazing. It was interesting. I don't remember a single thing he said, but it was amazing. It was interesting. I was captivated the whole time. Jesus, help us. Wisdom. Wisdom. Father will give us wisdom by the Spirit so that we can know things on a supernatural level.
Amen.
I praise God for the ability to retain information. You know, when I was early in school, 6th grade, 7th grade, 8th grade, they were concerned because I didn't read well. I read slow. And they never asked me, did I read? I read slow because I never read. They didn't expect to ask me that because I made good grades. I make good grades because I can remember what was said in the classroom. I never studied. When I got out of school at 2 o'clock, I went to play, man. It was time baseball, football, guns, war, everything you can think of, fishing, swimming. And I did that till dark. Then I dropped. And I just figured, well, you know, he's studying. Because look, he's making good grades. So it must be reading. I wasn't reading. I was a slow reader because I didn't read, you know. Praise God for the ability in the natural to be able to remember things. But now God will take it in a supernatural realm, and the Holy Ghost will impart these things to you if you get hungry and you get thirsty for these things.
Yes.
And I want this for you. There's got to be somebody in the earth that is the keeper of truth. There's got to be some place in the earth where the Word of God is in our mouth and in our heart, not doctrines of men and religious ideas. There's got to be some place where there's a people who are passionate and zealous for the Lord to speak His Word, not our own. And I'm going to plead because I know, I'm going to plead with you because I know God pleads with you.
Yeah.
The Empire of the Ten Kings. Empire of the Ten Kings, where is it represented? Empire of the Ten Kings, where is it represented? In the ten toes. That is correct. In the ten toes of Daniel chapter 2, that is not the seventh kingdom. That is, there's no little horn coming out of those ten toes. Hallelujah. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Huh? Don't be trying to second guess me and figure out what I'm talking about. I spent too many hours. You just get what I'm telling you. You go figure it out later. Are you listening to me? Huh? You better pay attention. I'm going to quiz you. Huh? I want to get this. I want you to get this. Daniel chapter 7, verse 8. Is that the empire of the ten kingdoms or is that the seventh kingdom? Daniel 7, 8. Daniel 7, 8. Huh? Trick question. It's both. It's both. It's both. What did you say? No. No. Daniel chapter 7, verse 8. That is the empire of the ten kingdom and the seventh kingdom. It's not the eighth. Are you listening to me? Do you understand why? Ask me the question. Why is that? Do you understand why? I want you to walk out of here understanding why. Do you understand why? Because the little horn comes up after. And after these ten kings, do you see that?
Yes.
Do you see that? Everybody see that?
Yes.
And after these ten kings, there came up also a little horn after. And when the little horn comes up, that is the Antichrist. That is the moment that he arises. That is the moment that he is revealed. He cannot be revealed until him who now hinders is removed.
True.
Then when he is revealed, what does he do? He comes with the power of Satan, with all miracles and signs and lying wonders to deceive the nations. Huh?
Yeah.
Baby, you know, only way you're not going to be deceived right now is to have the Word of God in you. The only way you're not going to be deceived right now is to walk in the Word of God, because it's the truth. Because by virtue, if you're not walking in the truth, you're walking in deception. Yeah, I got to get this to you. You got to understand how much more important the Bible is than your math book, than your financial investment book. Come on.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. Revelation chapter 13, verse 1, I saw a beast rise up out of the sea. It had a body of a leper. Had 10 horns. Which is it? Is that the kingdom of the 10? Is that the empire of the 10 kings, the 7th kingdom, or the 8th? It is the 8th. The key is the beast. The beast. Because the beast is both the expression of the man, Antichrist, now anointed with the angel that comes up out of the bottomless pit, and is also the description of the supernatural angel that comes up out of the pit, and is also the description of empire. It describes three things in the Scripture. Give me the verses of Scripture for them. Who knows them? You give me the chapters, because I'm going to tell you right now, you need to understand these things. You need to understand these things. And then another reason that you know, I have an indication that it is the eighth kingdom, is because now you're at the transition mark in the book of Revelation at the 3.5 year point.
Yeah.
42 months has passed. You're at the 3.5 year point. Okay. So we have many different, so we know that when, by Daniel, we already know that when he rises up, he continues the space of 42 months. Did anybody know that verse of Scripture? He continues the space of 42 months in Daniel. Can you even go with the chapter? Is it chapter 7? I'll give you three chances. Chapter 7, chapter 8, or chapter 9, which is it? People, I want you to just give yourself to these things, because it's not that hard. I know that every person in here has enough brain power, to get these things, because they're the most important events that are going to be taking place in our time period. Some of the most important events that we need to understand them. And it's just simply not that hard. Okay?
Yes.
The beast of Revelation chapter 17, I'm going to give you a hint. It's parenthetical. Revelation chapter 17 is a parenthetical chapter. The beast with 7 heads and 10 horns, upon which the mother of harlots is riding, is it the empire of the 10 kingdoms, 7th kingdom, or the 8th kingdom? I'm going to give you one more guess. I'm going to give you one more clue. Religion's in there. Is it the 7th kingdom or is it the 8th kingdom? It is the 7th kingdom. It is the 7th kingdom, because she is the dominant religion. The 10 kings will kill her, so that now they will worship only the Antichrist and Satan. They will kill the Babylonian religion and its cult, that it was all centered around the demons and the angels that they worship since Nimrod. The sorcery and the witchcraft that is involved in it, in that Babylonian cult. Hallelujah. Sikoromo Sitaranea. Hallelujah. I'm going to give you another one. I'm going to give you an advanced one. The terrible beast without horns. Is that a terrible... Even though you don't see a terrible beast without horns, I'm just going to give it a terrible beast without horns so that you can understand. The terrible beast without horns, pictured in Daniel chapter 7, verse 8, with horns, and then with a little horn coming up out of it. The terrible beast. Is it the kingdom, the terrible beast with no horns? Is it the kingdom, the empire of the 10 kings, the 7th kingdom, the 8th kingdom, or the Roman Empire? Come on, be bold. It's the Roman Empire. It's the same as the vision in Daniel chapter 8 and verse, what is it, 44? Of the western and the eastern divisions of the legs. Huh? Are you with me?
Yes.
Is everybody with me?
Yes.
I'm bone dead, I say a tie. Hallelujah. How many of you know that Caesar was actually anointed priest of the Babylonian cult, and it's in secular history, priest of the Babylonian cult? Caesar. Julius Caesar. Yeah, it's the religion. Has nothing to do with Mohammedism. Has nothing to do with Catholicism. I mean, poor Catholics. I mean, they took it right in the ribs big time. People should have known better. It's not the mother of harlots or mystery Rome. It's mystery Babylon. Can't ever be New York. Is New York on the map? Oh, somebody said it's New York. It's like, you know, when I hear people say that, I just, I don't even respond. Because it is so far from any concept of rational understanding of the scripture, I can't even respond to it. I'm just paralyzed. I just go paralyzed. It's just so left field. It's like bringing Chisabok into calculus. You know Chisabok? It's an ancient methodology of Japanese counting. Yeah, so bring Chisabok. And it's just so far out there, so irrelevant to anything. I want you to get this. I don't want to be found making fun of you in the future. See, I cannot believe that. They sat in the meetings. And they say in that stuff. What religion replaces the Babylonian cult represented by Mystery Babylon? Worship of the beast. And that's the best way to describe it, worship of the beast. Because it is an angel out of the bottomless pit. But see, the body, he has the body of the leopard, because the leopard represents who? Greece. So when you look back in Daniel chapter 7, you can see that the lion represented Babylon. You can see that the bear represented Media-Persia, and that the leopard represented Greece. The leopard with four heads, showing the four divisions of Alexander the Great's empire. Four primary major divisions. There were minor fragments, but the major divisions. Huh? And that out of one of them, then it's then later represented in chapter 8 as four horns to come out of the one that was broken off, not in battle, because he died. Not in battle. Huh? Four came up. Right? I don't know this for true in history, but it is folklore, at least it's legend, that Alexander the Great moved the seat of Satan to Pergamos himself from Media Persia, where it was kept. Some of you can do some research on that to validate that. I wouldn't doubt that he was part of the keep, because the seat of Satan, understanding the cult of Luciferian worship is in the Babylonian cult. Okay? It just comes to another level. When is Satan, the dragon, cast down out of heaven? When is he cast down out of heaven and made visible in the earth realm? He's cast down out of heaven and made visible in the earth realm. When does that happen? In the middle of the tribulation. And you see it pictured in Revelation chapter 12. It's a whole nother dimension, dear people. There's a whole nother dimension of the Luciferian cult. That's why I have a certain sense that there's some things there that aren't fully revealed to us for reasons that the Lord knows. That where, although in the Babylonian cult that will be destroyed, and it's seen the kings destroy it, and that is really symbolic to say we embrace the Antichrist as God Almighty. But somehow, the worship of Satan is elevated to another level. It's just not revealed. What kingdom of the seven heads was the first kingdom to be referred to as the dragon? Huh? And I give you a clue. And also Rahab. Egypt. It's rebellion. It's a defiance. And somehow in its, because it also was part of the Babylonian religion and the Babylonian cult. Somehow it had elevated satanic worship that we can only begin to surmise about it through Jannes and Jambres. Because remember, Jannes and Jambres are the first ones in the Bible that are revealed to be functioning in witchcraft and sorcery and soothsaying and enchantments. Huh? Yeah. Babylonian, huh?
Nimrod?
Well, no, because it is said of Nimrod later, like in Nahum chapter 3, verse 4, and of the Assyrian Empire and the Babylonian cult. But when we look at the first time witchcraft, sorcery is mentioned in the context of Egypt with Jannes and Jambres, which they used to withstand the anointing and the manifestation of the power of God, which is very important. We can just kind of brush over top of it and just act like, you know, well, it's just, you know, just, you know, way it is or whatever. I don't know how our brain shut down in terms of analysis. But it's there for the single purpose of stopping the anointing, withstanding the anointing, trying to eclipse the power of God being made manifest. You hear that?
Yeah.
You've got to understand there's more than meets the first glance at that contest of Jannes and Jambres and the display of the power of God through Moses. Were you going to say something? Wow, that's pretty powerful. Stuart's pointing out that the power of the Egyptian Empire really began after they were invaded by Babylon, and I can see that. But I believe too. I want to say this. I believe that when the nations, the people were scattered during the time of Babel. During the time that God changed everyone's language, that they carried with it the cult.
Yes.
Because the cult is seen in obscure places. The cult is seen in India. Isis for Ishtar, for the goddess of heaven. What is it? Moon Sing or something like that in China. I mean, just in all these remote places. I can't remember the Egyptian deity, which was also the Queen of Heaven, which was the same person, just a different name by the different language. And they carried with it the ziggurat in the pyramid, even seeing it down in South America, okay, and in various different forms of it and other emerging nations of power and their interaction with the angels. It's what it was all about, with fallen angels in the worship of demon spirits. So very important that you begin, that this is one of the things that I'm doing. I want to be able to help you understand that we highlighting the religion of these nations so that you might understand more clearly where this is all going. It's by plan that more people are being fascinated by the New Age. The New Age, all the New Age, that's Babylonian religion. It's the mysticism and the animism of making all these different things, the rocks and the plants and the trees with spiritual power. Only it gets bigger. Now all of a sudden it becomes a demon power and becomes an angelic power. It becomes these particular spiritual entities now that can come and give you power and help you in various different ways. It's all was created there in the cult of Nimrod, in the cult of the Babylonian, of the what we call the Babylonian cult. And I want you to see how it's building. I want you to see how it's gaining acceptance, sorcery and witchcraft, gaining acceptance and gaining momentum in so many different ways, not only New Age, but also in the movies and Harry Potter's. And it's not, look, it's not just innocent, and it's not just sterile people. All these witchcraft entities, these fairies, all of these things that go on and that look so innocent, and we let our kids play with it. People, it's dabbling in something that is anti-God. It is created to stop the anointing. It is the biggest anti-Christ, anti-God power that exists in the human realm. And we just want to make play games out of it. Because Disney's got us all, you know, hook, line, and sinker. You know what I'm saying? Reeling us in with whatever it is that they're, whatever bait they're throwing, we're biting. Whether we're hungry or not, biting. 5, 6 hooks in our mouth and we're going for another one. Huh? Are you with me?
Yes.
You ever been in a trout hole that's about 4 foot deep and 3 foot in diameter?
Yeah.
You'd think those trout have better sense than to bite on that hook because they can see you. You throw the hook in there. You know, it's just no real sportsmanship. But that's you and me. Come on, people. I think I've really made my points.
Good.
I think that you understand this.
Yes.
You understand this?
Yeah.
Is there anybody have some questions real quickly? Anyone with any questions?
The rider of the white horse in Revelation 6.
Rider of the white horse with a bow, with a crown, and with a bow.
With a crown, who goes out to conquer the nations?
Who goes out conquering and to conquer? Because there's no other place for the Antichrist doesn't come on the scene anywhere else.
Okay.
Where else can you see him? Unless we're only going to see him when he rises in the beast kingdom. We're not going to see him. We're not going to see him plucking up. We're not going to see him go forth to pluck up the three horns. And we know that in the timelines, if you study the timelines, and I'd be happy to take you through it, and it's a good question. Because there's some people who wanted to make that Jesus. Jesus comes riding with a crown and with a bow on a white horse at the beginning of the tribulation. And look at what's following him. Goodness gracious, death, famine, and hell?
Yeah.
What logic is there to that? Say what? You know. So we know it has to be the Antichrist. Because there is no place to unveil him. The hinderer is taking out so that he can be revealed. So there's no other place where he starts. And he's got to start at that time point, plucking up. That is the moment. The moment he starts to pluck up the three horns is the moment. The moment he appears is the moment of the seventh kingdom. As soon as the little horn is there, get this because it's important. As soon as the little horn is there, he's always got a mouth speaking blasphemies everywhere he's seen, everywhere you see him. Or his mouth speaking blasphemies is mentioned. Like I think it's like in Revelation chapter 11. I can't remember the verse. But nonetheless, I think it's verse 17, maybe 11, 17. But wherever he's mentioned, he's got this mouth speaking great blasphemies against God. Understand, wherever you see the little horn, that's seventh kingdom.
Right.
That's seventh kingdom. That's when he starts to pluck up. Are you with me?
Yes.
The eighth kingdom is as soon as he's anointed with the angel from hell. Just like as soon as he's anointed, a beast comes out of the bottomless pit. Now, some people say, well, he could be anointed with the beast that comes out of the bottomless pit previously at the very beginning. That is certainly legitimate. Why is it that I prefer to say, no, it happens, the anointing happens sometime in the middle of 3.5 years? Because I see the beast rise up out of the sea at chapter 13, and that's somewhere right at the 3.5 year period. If I saw the beast rise up earlier, that's why I believe he comes out of the bottomless pit to anoint him at that point in time. And it's a change. It's a change because now it's no longer the Romanism. It's no longer the Babylonian cult. It's a unique religious system. And also the false prophet who's anointed by an angel up out of the bottomless pit. He also stands up right there at that time, at the 3.5 year period. So it's a transition. It's a whole new cult. It's the Luciferian cult. And If I started going into that, we're going to be here till late. And then you're going to really be cross-eyed at me going, what did he just say? So you're going to have to study these verses of Scripture that I've given you. Just study these. Spend some time studying Daniel chapter 7, verses like 7 through, I believe it's 24. Just focus on it. Okay? Spend some time studying, just going back over Revelation chapter 17, the whole chapter. Okay? Go back then to Revelation chapter 8 and focus on what's being said there about, especially, I think it's like right around verse 6, where all of a sudden it's really focused on the four horns and the little horn that comes up out of it. Get this in context with 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 7 through 11. Get it to where that you can recall the details of it. Go back and study the vision then of Daniel chapter 2. Look at the dragon with 10 horns. See, it's dragon with 10 horns and no crowns, right? Go back and study the symbolism of Revelation chapter 12 and the dragon and understand the satanic, the Luciferian cult that is associated with those 10 horns. Are you with me?
Yeah.
Another evidence, because those 10 horns are there's no little horn there. It's the empire of the 10 kingdoms. Can you hear what I'm saying?
Yes.
Now, let me just tell you something. I was studying away at this very hard, okay? And all of a sudden, the Lord began to unveil this to me. I go back to Revelation expounded by Jennings Finest Dake and found the same points that I never saw. I'd never seen them. Or if I'd seen them, I'd forgotten them, and they didn't stand out to me as big. But I go back and, oh, he's got it too. He says, and he, like, I'm reading and I'm going, oh my goodness, he got this too. He's like, he says, I don't know how long it's going to exist, but there's this empire. And he just refers to it as this kingdom of 10 kings that has to exist before the Antichrist comes on the scene. I'm going, hey, you know, sometimes we've got to discover things on our own, because this is one little detail, because he doesn't talk about it long much. He doesn't say, I don't know how long it exists. It could, you know, he's trying to go in through his explanation, because he's already way out there, you know, on the fringes as far as everybody else is concerned, because most all the other prophets of his time were saying he was wild-eyed crazy, because he's saying that Israel's going to become a nation. Yeah. Guess what? He was right, they were wrong. How could have he been right and they was wrong? Because he was keeping with the word, and they weren't. They couldn't see how it would ever be possible that Israel could become a nation again. God, that's just symbolic. No, it's not, it's literal. Over and again, and I want to just emphasize that, and I'm going to close. I'm going to close if there's no more questions. Anybody else have any more questions? Anybody, any questions? Anyone with, yeah.
The beast with the seven heads and the ten horns.
Yeah.
The seven heads?
Pardon me?
What are the seven heads?
The seven heads? Egypt. They're in chapter 17, just read it, it'll tell you. And what you'll do is you can go back and you can look and understand from those visions in Daniel exactly, it will corroborate what four of them are, okay? But they're Egypt, they're Assyria. Why does it start with Egypt? Take a guess of why that the seven heads would start with Egypt.
It was the first one.
Was it the first empire that ever existed?
No.
Why do you think it started with Egypt? Does anybody know why it starts with Egypt?
Because Israel was there, right?
Huh? Because
they battled Israel first.
Yeah, that's right. So it is the first empire to oppress God's people, the saints. God's people, the saints, didn't exist until the Egyptian empire. I mean, it's like, you know, God calls out Abraham and makes a distinction. Before it was just the nations. Now it's the nations and God's people, God's saints. This is the first place of differentiation. And now what happens? Egypt oppresses God's saints. That Satan, the Babylonian cult, comes to destroy, to kill, to snuff out that which represents God. It's the Antichrist. And then we just travel down. The next great empire is the one that many historians believe was the first great empire, which is the Assyrian Empire, which was an amazing empire. Studied about the, you know, Assyrian. So Egypt, Assyria, then of course Babylon, and of course that's where it now takes up with what Daniel's saying. He takes it up with Babylon. Babylon, Media Persia, then you've got Greece, then you've got Rome, and then you've got the rise of the kingdom that is going to come and exist in the days when the Lord comes to set up his kingdom. And what's really interesting to note is that there's been almost 1,800 years between these empires. You know, if you say that the Roman Empire ceased to exist in the 3rd century, so 1,700 years, okay, between these two empires. Are you with me? And there's been 2,000 years, almost 2,000 years between Daniel's 69th week and his 70th week. And understanding that, understanding the 70th week is so important because that is the same as the 7-year tribulation, and it's highlighted with the same important peg in the ground, the abomination that makes desolate that happens in the middle of the week. Understanding the connectivity here, Daniel chapter 9 and chapter 10. Understand the connectivity here? Do you got this? Can you see it? Do you visualize it? Do you ponder it? Do you pray over it? Do you ask God, Father, am I going through this? Are you going to deliver me out of it? I mean, are you serious about your relationship with God? Are you just kind of paddling your way through life, hoping that it works out in the end? Get yourself a motorboat, man. Come on now. Let's go with this thing. Get yourself up. Get yourself, jump in. Don't walk around ankle deep. Dive in head first. Sink to the bottom and breathe. Get completely in on this stuff. I want you to get saturated. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. So what's most important that you've got to get about the symbolism, you need to spend more time with it. You need to think about this more. You need to go back and listen to all of the YouTubes. And probably many people in here do need to go back and listen to all the YouTubes, because it's something I'll say almost every time in the YouTubes. And because it's so important, because then you recognize the connectivity of all these kingdoms so that you may know the character, the nature, the politics, the geography, the sociology, and especially the religion. Otherwise, you're going to be deceived. If you don't know the religion, you're going to think it's Islam, Mohammedism. I thought one time back in the 70s that I got a revelation that the woman, the harlot, was Islam and Mohammedism. And so I said, well, I can trace, I said, okay, it's not Mohammedism because it hasn't existed long enough, but there is a predecessor, Islam, and I could see in the Islam the idolatry, so it must be some form of Islam. It's not Islam. Because Islam was not fully integrated into the Babylonian cult. It's more of a Bedouin religion. Huh? Are you with me? So that's what's so important, because you see that they share in common a list of things, and you need to make that list for yourself. Those seven kingdoms share in common more than just a religion, more than just the oppression of Israel. You need to understand that. I'm not going to go into that tonight, but you need to study that, because you can find it. It's going to cost you. You need to spend some time. Amen?
Amen.
I think I started yesterday at about 8 o'clock in the morning, and I stopped at 9:30 at night. I did stop 30 minutes and take a walk with my wife, but I didn't stop for lunch. I stopped a little bit. I kind of ate while I was working, because I'm into this stuff, people. I want you to be into this. I want you to get after this. I want you to understand this. I want to know the Word of God. I don't want to just speak something. I'm not interested in just having some facts to impress people with. Come on, I want to know what's going on. Don't you want to know what's going on?
Yeah.
If you get to know what's going to go on, why you sit down and watch the news, because you want to know what's going on. News isn't telling you what's going on. It's telling you what they want you to hear. Oh, yeah. Somebody gets in the background. Some writer says this is what we want people to believe. Tell them that. Tell them that's the news. This is what happened. This is what we want them to believe about it. Let's get the real news. Any other questions? I got a bunch of questions. I got a bunch of questions I could ask for you on your behalf. I'm not going to do it. Just give it just a few more minutes. Just Sikata la masia tiyana montuyana haseya. Well, amen. Amen. I pray that you got this. I pray that you'll just go and study these things. And then if you'll do it, when I send out, when I do my book, when I finish up the book, I'm going to have the book finished up over the next week or so. You know, I've got to put all my pictures and all my maps in there, and I've got, you know, a few more things. My last chapter for you to get this, my last chapter is a complete collapse of all society. My second to last chapter is the Luciferian cult. And I think if you know and understand where it's going, then you can see it. Oh, I see the Luciferian cult there. Well, I'm not going to have anything to do with it. In the Babylonian cult, they would throw a Yuletide log into the evergreen tree, and the evergreen tree would produce, by the demon spirit that was in it, presents. And they celebrated Yuletide on December 24th. And it has nothing to do with Jesus. I've been willing to just kind of like, you know, I can't fight every battle, but it's the Babylonian cult. There's much of the Babylonian cult. That's why people got carried away with saying Roman Catholicism is the mother of harlots. These weren't dumb people. These weren't idiot folks. These were serious people that said, look, we know. One guy had come out as, I believe, he was some kind of a priest. I don't know if he was cardinal or not, that high of a priest for the Catholic Church. And he said, listen. And he started writing these books and started giving this information back in the 1800s and saying, look, this is the Babylonian cult. This is the mother of harlots. Look. The Eucharist, the way that they stamp the Eucharist with that cross, that is a part of the Babylonian cult that goes back to ancient Assyria. You can trace the roots of it. So much of the symbolism, even the dress, the scarlet robes. And so there was so much symbolism that they said the Roman Catholic Church is the mother of harlots and gave a list of proofs that is a book that's yay thick to where that many of the people on the earth said, my goodness, because all the stuff about the blessing with the water, Babylonian cult. They actually do it with the same kind of instrument, same kind of headdress. It didn't come from Jewish tradition, didn't come from Christian tradition. It was the same headdress that was wore by Julius Caesar, who was anointed priest of the Babylonian cult, which they argued was transferred into the Western Division of the Roman Empire, and Constantinople was anointed priest of the Babylonian cult, and then he set it up in the Roman Catholic Church. Fine. There are symbolism of the Babylonian cult in Roman Catholicism. There's symbolism of the Babylonian cult in Protestantism. We actually got Esther, the Queen of Heaven, all of that symbolism, the eggs, the rabbit, all of it was part of the demon worship. And there's all these cults around it. There's all this witchcraft around it. There's a sorcery around it. It's crazy, but it's like we involved in it. And you can't fight every battle. Can you imagine if I started fighting those battles where I'm at already? I mean, I might as well just go live in a cave and talk to myself because nobody's going to listen to me, you know? They're going to like stamp on me, you know, Antichrist. And I can go on and on and on and on and on. I mean, when my wife was reminding me the other day, she said, you know, when you first married me, you would not have anything around that looked like a Christmas tree. You were radical about it. If anybody celebrated Easter and brought out the Easter eggs and you were on the soapbox. And I'm like looking back at myself. I said, that's why people said I was just so radical and I would calm down one day. And, you know, my mother and some other people came to me and said, listen, you know, you can't fight every battle. You just got to understand, people really have associated this with the birth of the Jesus. They don't understand the Babylonian cult. And so just invalidate it. And so I was willing to go along with that. But I'm just making some points here, people. The Babylonian cult has integrated in a whole lot of things that we do. Lent, it's the Babylonian feast. To then go through these 40 days, and at the end of it, they had these huge orgies and the worship of these demon spirits of intense immorality and lasciviousness, indulgence. It all came over. And it impacted Christianity for nearly 1,400 years. One of the popes, I can't remember which was, is in the 8th century. He knowingly took other elements of the Babylonian cult and sanctified them and brought them into the Roman Catholic Church, saying, knowing. I can't remember, but there's actually, because it's been so long since I studied this stuff, because I'm not interested in the false, I'm interested in the word. But I can tell you, and just publicly announce, this is the Babylonian cult, but it has so much importance within the context of our ritual. In the Babylonian cult, they had the Queen of Heaven who had the sun god. Huh? And guess who the sun god was? Nimrod. And then his wife was promoted to be the Queen of Heaven. And she became the one that everybody began to worship. And that was what was reproduced in all of these various different Isis to Isis, Isis of Egypt, Isis, Venus of Rome, the goddess of impurity. Huh? Juno was the sun. Venus is the Queen of Heaven. Well, okay. Look at it again. Just look at that again, because I'm not an expert on that. I'm not, but just check it one more time for me, because you've always got the Queen of Heaven and her son in every cult, in every expression of the Babylonian cult. I'm just trying to help people understand the element, the climate, the things that are actually tokens, evidence within our society that we embrace as harmless. So we can't go pointing fingers just, you know, at one when we got a bunch in ourselves. And we just want to get, just, you know, the Lord says come out. Babylon is the only place that the Lord tells his people to come out from the midst of. Guess where God called Abraham from? The middle, one of the capital cities of Babylon. And he's been continually calling his people, come out of Babylon. Come out of the midst of her. Huh? Spiritual Babylon. Mystery Babylon. Spiritual Babylon is in existence today. Is mystery spiritual Babylon in existence today? Is it just need to be with the kingdoms? Is he in existence today? The prince of the power of air. Satan, God gave him in all of his principalities and spiritual wickedness a place called the high places. A heavenly realm called the high places. Listen to me, people. I want you to get this, because we think that everything's all sterile and normal. We've normalized everything. And we don't understand that there's still a lot of stuff going on. I don't want to go into it because I'm going to start sounding flaky here. But there is a lot of mediums. There are a lot of things, even from music. And that's one of the things that I warn people about music, because it is a medium. And it's always been a medium. And dance has always been a medium. It's always been a medium. There's sanctified dance and there's unholy dance. There's demonic dance. There's sanctified music and there's demonic music. It's mediums. And I can talk about a lot of different mediums. Okay? Alcohol being one of the most ancient ones. Alcohol and other forms of drugs, whether it's marijuana or whether it's other kind of opiates, mushrooms, various different toxic things that are in the earth that Westerners call peyote, things that have been always in always part of the cult, the Babylonian cult of interacting with demons, worshiping angels. It's a spiritual world. We're saying, oh, well, I feel good. Now you're in another world and you're going to hear some stuff, and emotions are going to be messed with. Affections are going to be messed with by demon spirits. It's imbibing spirits. If I feel like that if I can set the stage within the context of what's really been going on from antiquity, and that it wasn't a bunch of superstition, it was a higher sense of perception, that I can help people then understand more perfectly the things that Satan has disguised himself with in harmless things, and even things that we know that are wrong. We should call them sin, but somehow we haven't found the ability to recognize the demon power behind it, the angel that has come to hunt our souls. And when we do, now I'm ready for the battle. Come on, I'm fit and I'm equipped. It's not some kind of harmless little thing. It's all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, the pride of life. It is a demon stronghold. It's a demon power that Satan uses to defy God, to enslave men, to destroy the souls in hell. And remember, at the center of the cult, I wanted to say this, at the center of the cult is intense sexual immorality. At the center of the cult, wow. It's intense sexual immorality. All of the temple prostitutes had to be anointed in Babylon, in Nineveh. That is where they were anointed. They were anointed specifically by the Queen of Heaven, the wife of Nimrod. And then that perpetuated itself. And it's fundamental to the religion of the mother of harlots. Huh? So I want you to think, so I want you to spend some time with that. I want you to spend some time meditating on Nahum 3:4. Just get that verse of scripture. Understand that, Nahum 3:4. Understand that Nineveh is the capital of Babylon. Understand that. Amen. My spirit is so filled with these things, I just can't hardly let them go because I just want you to get them. I want you to have them. I don't care if I you know, spend all night saying the same thing over and over again, but I'm done. Yes, dear.
So all societies around, other than it's highlighted, is collapsed. What is going on with the people that are in collapsed societies? Are they all
No, it's not that they're necessary. That's not necessarily a collapsed society. You know, you're looking at, you know, a lot of Russia there, right? And you know, you're looking at you know, the lower parts of Saudi Arabia there, right? You're looking at that's Africa, down in here. It's just that what we're looking at is the world power. Like the U.S., China, and Russia are the world powers right now. That's the world power. They have the dominant influence in the world, and that's. That's the importance of understanding that. Does Russia still exist? Yeah, Russia still exists in some form because, as I said, the Antichrist sitting there in Syria, the northern king, is going to hear rumors from the north, and which is going to be Russia because that's the first place that's outside of his reach and outside of his realm and territory. He's going to make war with them. Okay? And so there exists. China exists. India, Pakistan, they exist because he's going to gather the kings of the East. They're just not part of this dominant power. This is the dominant power from which the Antichrist arises. Okay? Did you have a question?
Well, I've always been taught that Russia was not included in the North.
That what?
That Russia was not the king of the North, that Syria was the king of the North.
Well, you understand that Syria is the place from which the Antichrist arises, but he is going to hear rumors from the north. He is the king of the north, and he's going to hear rumors from the north, which is only Russia. Look at the map. Okay, look at the map. That is under his power. I don't care what any little book you have says. That is the Roman Empire, and it is under his power. Do you see that? That, if you know your geography, that right there is the borders right there. Well, actually, some of that is actually modern-day Russia. But that is clearly the borders of Europe and Russia. Are you with me? That's the only powers outside of that which is already under his authority that could be in the north that he's going to go fight against. Do you understand that? Do you understand that? Okay. One of the arguments used to be Russia was where the Antichrist comes from Gog and Magog, and so one of the questions of people who were astute says, well, okay, if Russia is the king of the north, and he hears rumors of the king of the north that he's going to go fight against, who's he fighting against? The polar bears. So that should have helped people understand that he didn't come out of Russia, okay? That he has to be understood as another king of the north within the framework of another empire. And that empire then would be what? What we would call, what some call the revived Grecian Empire. I just don't like using those words. I think that those are catchphrase words. I don't like using revised Roman Empire. I think that those things are shrouded by other definitions. I don't like using revived Grecian Empire. But if you use the revived Grecian Empire, he's the king of the north. And he's called the king of the north. But nonetheless, it doesn't take away that he's going to hear in the middle of tribulation rumors. Because he's set to destroy all of Israel. And if he didn't hear rumors from the king of the north, which is then he would have not left off pursuing them. So he leaves off pursuing the destruction and annihilation of Israel to go fight the kings of the north, which is right up here. Do you understand? Do you understand? If you don't understand, you need to understand because this is the way it is. Okay? Pardon me?
Part of Russia, from what Jake teaches, used to border Syria.
No, I think that you need to restudy Dake, okay? I think you really need to restudy what he's saying in complete context. I just recently reread his book. So I know what he says. I know what Larkin says. So it'd be good for you to go study that because you're not correct, okay? And so, you know, what you want to do is you don't want to be studying while I'm trying to talk to you because you want to get this information. Then take the information, go offline and try to figure it out. And then ask questions. Okay, do you understand? What you're missing, Geneva, and you've missed tonight, is you've missed the boundaries of the Empire of the Ten Kings. And no, Geneva, you're missing. You're trying to say that somehow the King of the North bordered Syria. And it just isn't the case. This is the old Roman Empire. You must understand this. This is the old Roman Empire. This is the context of the old Roman Empire. These are the eastern and the western divisions on three continents. You have to understand this. By the middle of the 3.5 years, all of these powers will have given their authority over to him. That everybody agrees with, that is biblically sound, prophetical doctrine, prophetic doctrine, okay? Everybody agrees with that. So when the king of the north here, Syria, hears rumors of the king of the north confederation making war against him, it isn't going to be any of these kingdoms right here up against him, which would be, because he's in Asia Minor, basically. Turkey would be right there bordering him. Okay? And it's not going to be Turkey. It's going to make war against him. And the Ottoman Empire is not part of Russia. Anybody know the Ottoman Empire ever being part of Russia? Ottoman Empire has never been part of Russia. And it never will be part of Russia, so far as we know. You have to go further north. Do you understand that?
Yeah.
Okay. And so that the point here is to just help you recognize that although Russia is today a world power, it certainly doesn't stand as a world power there, but at the same time, there is some form of existence because you could argue that we all blow ourselves up. Uh-huh. That, you know, just like China and Russia are running joint naval exercises right now, and they want to invade U.S., that the U.S., China, and Russia could basically have annihilated each other, and they don't even exist. Okay, you can put that as the list, one of the possibilities. That all of that is barren wasteland. I've been blown up on nuclear power. Huh? But that just isn't the case because he's got a war against King of the North, which is nothing other than Russia. Absolutely. And furthermore, the Euphrates will be dried up so that the kings of the East. Well, who are the kings of the East on the other side of Euphrates? Who are the kings of the East on the other side of Euphrates? Huh? I'm going to tell you right now, China and India make it up. Because right now they have half the population of the earth. Now I know there's going to be some serious changes and 1/3 of men, but if 1/3 of men are destroyed in the tribulation, and especially when you think about a lot of it being concentrated right there. Now, I'm going to tell you right now, there's a lot of different folks that believe that it's all concentrated right there. I don't believe it's concentrated right there. I've got proofs. Now, I haven't just jumped off the bandwagon here yesterday, rolled off the truck, and come up with some ideas. I mean, I've been laboring over these things. I read and reread everybody else's comments on these things, but then I go back to the Word. And I say, well, what does the Word say? I want to stick with the Word. Because sometimes people have had to fence themselves, and I understand that. None of us get it all right. Okay? But I'm not, you know what? I don't follow word by word, line by line, something that somebody else said. Dake said it. I don't care if Dake said it. By and large, I haven't found really a lot of things that Dake said that was wrong. Or Larkin said, well, I want to hear what Larkin said, but if it's contrary to the Word of God, I'm not interested. Okay, he's going to have to justify the verses of Scripture that are very clearly presented there. So China and India make up, by 2020 is the way things are going right now, they make up more than half the population of the earth. So if 1/3 of the earth is destroyed, 1/3 of humanity is destroyed, they still got the majority of the population. So, I mean, if you say that the kings of the East don't include China and India, I mean, I just don't even get that. What, it's Nepal? Pakistan, Afghanistan. I mean, come on. And they're not formidable powers. And really what we're looking at is we're looking at formidable powers that are now brought in under his authority. He rises up here. So for 3.5 years, as the beast kingdom, he's busy with the kings of the north. By and large, he's busy with the kings of the north, making war with the kings of the north. And his false prophet actually raises up the armies of the east. Go read it again. Go read it again. Then he comes. Now, this is where he comes back to finish off the job of Revelation chapter 12. He's going to come out and finish off the job. Are you with me? He's coming to finish off. Are you with me? He comes in the power of Satan, the dragon with 10 horns. He comes in the power of Satan to destroy Israel during when he proclaims himself God, because he's going to say, if you don't worship my image and you don't take my mark, you're dying. You're going to be beheaded. And he starts with the saints. He's given power to make war on the saints and to make war on the heavens, to pull down the host of heaven and to trample them. Now you start. There are very few people who've ever even set out to deal with that reality. And yet that is given to us in 4 different verses of Scripture. And I'm not going to go into that tonight. I'm hitting you with some really surface stuff here. Okay? So, very important points. He now brings all of these kings because he conquers them. He gave them power to conquer. He's given power to conquer. He goes forth conquering and to conquer. He brings the kings of the north and the kings of the east, some which he's gotten by force, some which he's gotten by deception through his false prophets. And now he brings them back to finish the job. Where are we at right now? We're at the end of the 7 years. Huh? Who now comes to help withstand him and his leagues? Because he's got armies all over the place in here. He's got 10 kings helping him. Doesn't he? He doesn't have to take all of the power. And guess what? God raises up Elijah and Enoch, the 2 prophets, to stand, to help protect Israel, to stand against the forces of the Antichrist until he brings down with him all of his armies. And now he brings all of his armies down. And where does he bring his armies to? Once again, this speaks to all of the 7 kingdoms. He brings his armies down to do what? Annihilate Israel. Where do they end up in? The Valley of Megiddo. How far does this stretch? Probably from Lebanon all the way down to Edom. When the Lord comes, what does he do? Does he first come to Megiddo? No. There's something going on in Bozrah and Timon. Ancient Edom is now raised up again, according to the prophet Obadiah. Once again, very few prophets deal with that. Because why? You're going out on a limb. These guys have already gone out on a limb before us, okay? We've got to be willing to go ahead and say, wait a minute, got to bring this in. The Lord Jesus comes with his garments dipped in blood from where? Not Megiddo. Bozra. Huh? Bozra. Right? Edom. What's going on there? What is it right now? It's just a bunch of rock rubble in little small huts. How many people are living in Bozra? 200 people? 4 probably. And it's going to be an empire. Because the scripture says Obadiah opens up and says all the nations wonder at her. Think about it. So there's a lot more going on here than meets the eye, people. Don't just be, you know, one night prophet, you know, prophetic, scripture interpreters. Are you with me? Please. Dig in. Dive in. Get in deep. Understand this. I have laid out for you very clear revelation that I don't care if you'd say Dake, Larkin, Clark, Gill, others all taught. They didn't teach it with that kind other than Dake. Dake is the only one I think, and Larkin, because most of what Dake got, he got from Larkin. They didn't teach with all plainness of speech the empire of the 10 kingdoms. They just said there has to be 10 kings with 10 kingdoms before the Antichrist comes. Are you with me? Yes. Everybody here?
Yes.
Okay? Don't hold on to what you think you know. Learn. Okay? Amen. Don't be stubborn. Amen. Okay? Submit yourself. Amen?
Amen?
Any other questions? Any other issues? Anybody want to bring up? You're not sure if China even exists anymore? or if Russia even exists? Word by word, Daniel, word by word. That's good.
That's a great place to start for people trying to start over.
Yeah, and really what you want to do, and I'm going to say this. Yeah, it's valuable to read books. It's valuable to hear comments about that other people have said and the way they frame things up. At some point in time, you got to lay all that aside. And you got to get yourself separated with the Word of God, and you've got to say, Lord, I want to understand this.
Amen.
And then you're going to have to start, because otherwise you're going to miss things. Even though, like I was saying today, you know, or earlier, I was saying, wow, I went back and because I just recently reread Revelation Expounded. And I'm looking through there and I'm going, because I'd come to understand the Empire of the Ten Kingdoms, which I call the Empire of the Ten Kings, rather, and in a new light. And then I go back and I read something that I've read, I've read this many times. And it was the points that Dake, for example, were making were so subtle, they never stood out to me. But now, because it's such a huge thing to me, it's like, wow, he got it. You know, he mentions it five different places in Revelation Expounded, right at the very beginning. In fact, I was telling Rob about this today. Is Rob still here, Rob? And Rob says, yeah, look, I highlighted this. What was that, like 25 years ago? Longer. And there it is, the Ten Kings. The kingdoms of the Ten Kings must exist before the Antichrist comes. And I'm like, wow, you know, I know I read that, and I know it went by me, but it never was solidified in me, you know, that this has to form first. So I'm saying that to make a point. I've spent my life studying this, and I'm not a real big dummy, but yet there's so much detail, there's so much information here. You can spend a lifetime studying it. And if you're hungry, and if you're thirsty, and if you're passionate about it, it's going to constantly grow. It's going to constantly mature. The picture is going to become more and more clear. Huh? Some people get stuck. They get stuck in religion, man. They get stuck. This is what so-and-so said, and that's what I believe. Or you get to say, wait a minute, Father, I want to get the complete picture. I'm going to build off of what so-and-so said, so long as they're sticking with the Word. And we can go from there. Amen?
Amen.
Okay. I know this has been a long one. Bless all of your hearts. Love you. Make sure that you don't leave this place tonight without hugging people. Tell them that you love them. Bless them. Okay? All the questions were good. There was nobody way out.